present Kenneth Williams, Peter Jones, Clement Freud and Aimi MacDonald in just a minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you very much. Hello and welcome once again to Just a Minute. They're going to try and speak as usual, if they can, on the subject that I will give them without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject on the card. And Clement Freud, we'd like you to begin the first round, and the subject on the card is Aimi MacDonald. A nice subject to have anywhere. But will you talk about Aimi MacDonald in just a minute, starting now?
If you were to look for someone who could play with three regular men, I cannot think of more suitable applicants than Aimi MacDonald.
Kenneth Williams has
deviation. Chuckled. He said more suitable applicants,
yes,
than Aimi MacDonald, so you can't have a singular in a plural, can you?
No. Aimi, I mean, she could pass for three people, but to me...
If you don't want it embroidered, just give me this.
You started very early this week.
Yes, hurry up. Come on, it's my subject. Come on, wait a minute.
All right, Kenneth, let me explain for those who've never heard the game before. And there
finished.
Are some. You had a correct challenge
Thank
here.
You.
I agree with that.
Thank
so you get a point for a correct challenge. You
Thank
take
you.
Over the subject. And
challenge.
There are 49 seconds left. And it is the subject is Aimi MacDonald, starting now.
Aimi MacDonald descends from a long and very distinguished line, the family of that ilk. Indeed, one of them, Flora MacDonald, as you well know historically,
Aimi MacDonald is challenged. That...
Well, I don't think I've anything to do with Flora.
Well, you're closer to margarine, are you?
No, I don't think I'm descended from her. I didn't really want to interrupt because it sounded quite good.
Well, pity you did then, you stupid great nit.
I thought Flora MacDonald died unmarried.
There are 38 seconds left. The subject is still with you. Aimi MacDonald, starting now.
She has pursued a long and varied career in the theatre and achieved quite a lot as a sort of danseuse, as the French always put it. And since we're in the common market, it seems appropriate to bring that in too, because she has been to Paris. She went there once and got it all wrong. So, can't have the language.
Hesitation.
No, I don't think he hesitated. He never stopped. So, there you could have him for deviation, not hesitation. 20 seconds are left and you've still got the subject, Kenneth. And another point for an incorrect challenge. Aimi MacDonald's the subject and you start now.
Yes, she says it like, ooh, aye, la toilette, or abbez-vous.
Aimi MacDonald has challenged.
That's on the grounds that it's just not true.
Absolutely untrue.
I know how to say, ooh, aye, la toilette.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
There you go. So, Aimi, you have a correct challenge, you have a point, you take over the subject. There are 17 seconds left, and the subject, Aimi MacDonald, is Aimi MacDonald.
Oh, dear, I forgot I'd have to do that.
Yes, well, you've got to talk about Aimi MacDonald starting now.
Oh, well, it's actually terribly difficult for someone to talk about themselves, if you know what I mean. In this instance, I happen to be lumbered with Aimi MacDonald. When I say that she is an amazing lady, I'm sure you will all agree. Kenneth Williams has...
Well, Aimi MacDonald, aside being overcome by the fact she had to talk about herself, did manage it for 15 seconds, and when the whistle went, she was still speaking, so she gained an extra point for that, and she's in second place at the end of the first round, and Kenneth Williams, of course, is in the lead, and Peter Jones begins the next round. And Peter, we'd like you to talk on the subject of Kenneth Williams. So, Kenneth, tell us something about your big rival in just a minute, starting now.
It's not long enough. I could talk about Kenneth Williams for days on end. And I know at least one person who would be prepared to listen to me. Kenneth, underneath that saintly exterior, he does a tremendous amount of good by stealth. And it's certainly true that no one has heard about him doing much good. And occasionally, I think, when he gets off on cloud nine like he did recently, I think it's because he's eating too much protein. He is one of the people described by that sandwich board carrier in Oxford Street who should cut down on meat, because it obviously overexcites him, and he gets carried away, as he is now.
Aimi MacDonald has challenged.
Did you say we're allowed to do Earth?
I haven't said anything.
Earth or Ue la toilette. It's actually a... if you want to... Turn left.
No, you did a little in there.
You did quite a big and then there's a hesitation. So, Aimi, you have a correct challenge. You have 10 seconds, and the subject is Kenneth Williams, and you start now.
Well, Kenneth Williams I first knew about when I started to do a programme called Just a Minute. This man has all...
Clement Freud.
I just don't believe it.
Yeah, quite right.
But I was going on to explain what I meant, darling. You didn't give me time.
Well, I haven't believed it so far.
I think that's a good
challenge. It came out the wrong way. I didn't
And it often does on Just a Minute, and you've got to be very careful, especially...
I myself came out the wrong way.
As long as you pop it back in again, Aimi, no one's going to worry.
Yes.
There are 2 seconds for you, Clement Freud, a correct challenge, and the subject is Kenneth Williams, starting now.
I heard of Kenneth Williams at the very beginning of this century.
At the end of that round, Kenneth Williams and Aimi MacDonald are equal in the lead, and Kenneth Williams, it's your turn to begin, and the subject, very confusing, isn't it, is Clement Freud. So will you please tell us something about Clement Freud in Just a Minute, starting now?
What a formidable task to describe a man, both raconteur, orator, wit, a great charmer, and handsome to boot. This is a difficult, onerous, indeed, imposition, but I will endeavor to meet it. For not only in public life is this man enlightening as well as fun, but as a host, immeasurable. We can't say in words that would really do justice to this man's culinary brilliance.
Peter Jones has challenged.
The repetition of this man.
Yes.
I was enjoying it.
Yeah.
The only time Clement Freud has ever challenged you. There are 22 seconds left for you, Peter Jones, to take the subject of Clement Freud, starting now.
Kenneth needs a game called Just an Hour and a Half.
Aimi MacDonald challenged.
He said Kenneth needs a game called Just an Hour and a Half, and then he waited like an hour
yes,
and a half.
Yes, in other words, he hesitated.
Yes, hesitated.
Aimi, you have the subject. You have 17 seconds, and the subject is Clement Freud, and you begin now.
I think it's marvellous anyway that someone can be an actor, have the time to be a personality, work on radio shows, etc. But I think it's doubly fascinating that someone can do all...
Peter Jones has challenged.
A repetition of fascinating.
You're right, Peter. 4 seconds
no,
are left.
One was fascinating, one was doubly fascinating.
Yeah. Well, then it was a double repetition.
Aren't we all?
It is when you speak it. 4 seconds, Clement Freud is the subject. With you, Peter Jones, starting now.
I worshipped at the shrine of Clement Freud this side.
So, at the end of that round, it's a very even contest. Peter Jones has now taken the lead alongside Aimi MacDonald. Kenneth Williams 1 point behind. And you might be surprised to hear that in fourth place it's Clement Freud. Aimi, we're back with you to begin. And the subject, there's only one person left. It could be Peter Jones. So will you please talk on Peter Jones in Just a Minute, starting now?
I think Peter Jones is so divine. When I first started doing a show called Just a Minute, I, to be very honest, was petrified. I didn't know what would be expected of me. I was scared stiff.
Kenneth Williams.
She still doesn't.
That's cheating. He only said that to get a laugh.
Yay, you're my She's nice.
That was very observant of you, Aimi.
Do I get a point for
Yes, of course you get a point. Peter Jones is a subject starting now.
I mean, the thought of working with Clement Freud and Kenneth Williams all at the same time was just too much...
Clement Freud.
Both at the same time, yes, deviation.
She was including herself, you see. There were actually three. It's very typical of Clement to ignore the third party.
No, she said working with, and then...
Yes, but I'm leaving the subject with Aimi, and there are 40 seconds left. It is Peter Jones, the subject, starting now.
What rescued me, of course, was the fact that Peter Jones was ever present. Because you...
Clement Freud is challenged again.
Deviation, he's what? Not.
No. She prefaced it with when she was on the show.
He has always been present when I've been on the show.
I quite believe you, Aimi. I wouldn't doubt you for a moment. And
I think it's a contractual condition, isn't it?
Is that why you work cheap? 33 seconds are left for the subject of Peter Jones with you, Aimi MacDonald, starting now.
See, the others don't know, but I have it in my contract that Peter does the show with me. So that when Kenneth Williams stands up and says, why do we have these dumb blondes on the show? Peter comes to my rescue.
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of Kenneth Williams.
It was Clement who challenged that, was it?
That's right, yes.
Mm. Rather typical, that, isn't it? I mean, if she'd repeated Clement Freud, I suppose Kenneth would have challenged. People like to hear their own name, but they can't bear the other person's name.
So, Clement Freud, you have a correct challenge in 19 seconds on the subject of Peter Jones, starting now.
Peter Jones is really one of the very best chaps I have ever met. I worship at the shrine of Mr. Jones, regardless of whether this be in Brighton or St. John's Wood, where he has his town residence. Peter Jones, 5'11".
Aimi MacDonald challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, Aimi. And you've got in with only 3 seconds to go on the subject of Peter Jones, starting now.
Tall, handsome, charming.
Hesitation.
No. You have 2 seconds on Peter Jones, Aimi MacDonald, starting now. Yes, I agree. 1 second on the subject of Peter Jones.
Wouldn't you to have a store named after him?
So, Aimi MacDonald, you won't be surprised to hear, gained a lot of points in that round. She's way out in the lead. Kenneth Williams is in second place, Peter Jones in third, and Clement in fourth place. Clement Freud, it's your turn to begin. The subject is oil. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I was on a television show in New York very recently when the question master or host said that unless there was more oil in America, they were seriously considering invading the Emirates, to which I asked whether, if they ran short of whiskey, would they wage war against Scotland. The man got exceedingly angry and said that he felt that every country in the world had a right to have energy as and where it pleased, which I must say politically I totally disagree with. Oil is a finite somebody tell
me. Aimi MacDonald, challenge.
Good. I'd like to hear Aimi on oil.
Aimi, you have 23 seconds. The subject is oil. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I like to watch television where they show the little commercial with the sausage sitting in a refrigerator and the potato chip. Because, you see, if you use a certain kind of oil, you can actually fry things without them smelling like other things or tasting like certain other objects.
Kenneth Williams has a chance.
You've got two lots of light.
Yes, and things, right. Kenneth, you're in with 6 seconds to go on the subject of oil, starting now.
We know in the Bible it tells the unwise virgins did not put oil in the lamp. Now,
well, Kenneth Williams is now creeping up on our leader, Aimi MacDonald, and Peter Jones is going to begin the next round, and the subject is red herrings. Peter, will you tell us something about that, starting now?
Well, red herrings in themselves are a sort of deviation. They were used originally, I think, to confuse foxhounds by...
Aimi MacDonald has challenged.
Yes. You do that so sweetly there, Jack.
And you challenge so sweetly, too. But you have 49 seconds on the subject of red herrings, starting now.
Oh, and I don't know what I'm going to talk about, but I think I know what it's all about. It's when you buy a book, for example, which might be a thriller, you take it on the train with you, and it will keep you very amused, because half the time you will be thinking that somebody did it that didn't really do it, if you know what I mean. And that will turn out Clement to be Freud the best...
challenge.
I don't.
I think everything you were doing...
That's really what we meant.
There are 27 seconds with red herring still with you, Aimi, starting now.
And I'm sitting on the train...
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of train.
Yes.
Oh, darling, I'm just starting where I left off.
I know, but you should have stayed on the train, not got on and got off again. Clement, you have the subject of red herrings, and there are 26 seconds starting now.
My son Matthew took me to the cinema to see a film called Alien, in which there was one of the most amazing red herrings.
Aimi MacDonald challenge.
Oh, just, I saw that too. It was a fantastic
film. You thought that was a red herring that suddenly appeared, did you?
No, oh, it was an amazing film, though. Mm-hmm.
Anything else you want to say?
No, that was it.
So, Clement Freud has a point for a non-challenge, and there are 19 seconds on red herrings starting now.
In which a cat was shown to have eaten, one supposed, having watched the movie, the monster, and...
Kenneth Williams.
Deviation, well, that has to do with red herrings.
Well, I don't think we've got to the subject of red herrings. Kenneth, you have 11 seconds on red herrings starting now.
The thing to do with red herrings is to get a great crate of them and get on a train with a thriller and go and see a load of aliens hanging about Paddington Station in top hats wearing bright garland albums.
Clement Freud has challenged, I'm afraid.
Oh, has he?
It's deviation. You can't get a crate of red herrings.
I don't know. You get a crate and have the herrings all be red. Right, so you have 2 seconds, 3 seconds on red herring starting now.
They are deliberately employed to...
So Kenneth is moving ahead. He's still 2 points behind Aimi MacDonald, but Clement Freud and Peter Jones are for once trailing. Kenneth, it's your turn to begin. The subject is the Ancient Mariner, and will you tell us something about him in just a minute? Oh, you've got your literary cultural face on now. 60 seconds starting now.
Coleridge has something in common, I think, with Alexander Pope insofar as his poetry is, in effect, moralistic. He himself said it did not contain tenderness or passion. Now, the Ancient Mariner deals with the intervention of extraordinary supernatural forces in a human drama. A terrible deed is done. The sin of killing a friendly bird. For which a terrible vengeance is extracted, and then all stilled, everything damned, no energy allowed to seep through. One act can result.
Aimi MacDonald has challenged.
I don't know what he's talking about.
Oh, God.
I think that's extremely honest of you, Aimi. And it was lovely hearing from you, but he was actually being very interesting about...
Was he?
Yeah.
Yes.
The Ancient Mariner.
This old sailor, you know.
Kenneth, you have this... a point for an incorrect challenge, and you have 16 seconds left on The Ancient Mariner, starting now.
So with a love for what are slimy water snakes, he conceives an act of love for... What is it? I mean,
Clement Freud.
It's ruinous to play this game with the literates because the whole point is you can't concentrate. I mean, they can't. It's something apparent. After that, you just completely ruined.
Kenneth, we do have as much fun and jokes from other members of the team as from you when they interrupt.
I'm not here for fun and jokes. I'm here to enlighten people. They want to know about the Ancient Mariner. They're going to go home eagerly to read their books about it, aren't you? There you are, you heard them. Fun and jokes.
Yes.
Well, have you written a book on the Ancient Mariner?
What?
You haven't written a book on the Ancient Mariner, have you?
Written a book on the Ancient Mariner? What
I heard you'd written a book on indoor games for flag days.
Yes.
And I thought perhaps you'd written one on the Ancient Mariner.
So Clement Freud has a correct challenge, and there are 6 seconds on the Ancient Mariner starting now.
It was an Ancient Mariner, and he stoppeth one of three. Now, I played a wedding guest when I was at school, but unfortunately...
So, the subject, you might be surprised to hear, is having fun. Aimi MacDonald, it's your turn to begin. Will you take that subject and start now?
There are many different ways of having fun, of course. Kenneth Williams likes to go home and read about old sea captains. I have other things in mind. I love to go out at night with a few friends and have a nice little something to eat in a nice little restaurant. I said nice twice, didn't I?
Well, let's see what Kenneth's challenge
is.
I was going to say repetition and also completely
yes, you're absolutely right.
I totally repetition of the word nice.
And Kenneth, you have...
sea captain. Nothing wrong.
Young sea captain.
I got it.
I couldn't say that. You can ask the old sea captain.
Kenneth, you have the subject of having fun.
What?
Having fun.
Oh, having fun, yeah.
Is what we like to do in just a minute, whether with ancient sea captains or not. And there are 43 seconds left, starting now.
Fun in the old days was with Al Bowley and those sort of bands where you danced the foxtrot or the rumba, and there was gaiety and music and lights and a sort of abandon, which I think is now gone and has been replaced by modern music, which seems totally...
Clement Freud has...
Repetition of music.
Yes, I'm afraid so. Okay, so Clement Freud has the subject, and there are 24 seconds left on having fun, starting now.
It has been argued that rabbits have more fun than people because they're more honest. On the other hand, people have less
Jones
fun than rabbits.
Hesitation. Yes, said there was, yes.
It and was very difficult to tell that without repeating rabbits and people.
And there are 15 seconds left for Peter Jones to tell us something about having fun, starting now.
Well, I don't know why Kenneth was going on about the old dance bands and the Café de Paris in that era.
Kenneth...
Well, he should know.
Why should he know?
Look at him! He shambles in here like some derelict. and then comes out with his son about me knowing about it. Why yuck.
So what is your challenge after all that?
Oh, no, it's a comment. I beg your pardon.
So a comment gets a point for the person who was interrupted.
Look at his face, though.
Peter Jones, you continue with the subject of having fun, starting now.
What amazed me was that he described them as abandoned those days. And, of course, they were quite the reverse. We are much more so now than we ever were then.
Well, we have an interesting situation in the contest because Peter Jones and Clement Freud are now equal, but they're way behind our two joint leaders who are Aimi MacDonald and Kenneth Williams. And Clement, we're back with you to begin. The subject is the duties of a host. Will you tell us something about those in just a minute, starting now?
The duties of a host are manifold. And
Kenneth Williams...
It's not many, it's manifold, so we can't have that. That's easy.
There are 57 seconds for the duties of a host with you, Kenneth, starting now.
The duties of a host are beautifully illustrated by that story of Edward VII who entertained a Indian potentate and during...
Clement Freud.
An Indian potentate.
Clement Freud, you had a correct challenge, and you have 49 seconds on the duties of a host, starting now.
You must go into your guest's bedroom and make sure that the books which are put out are those...
Aimi MacDonald.
So you must go into your guest's bedroom, supposing the guest is in there.
How nice for the guest, especially if it was you who went in there. Clement Freud, it was an incorrect challenge, so you keep the subject, and there are 43 seconds on the duties of a host, starting now.
It is not unimportant to ascertain that garlic and other strong foods are to the taste of the person whom you are about to invite to stay with you. And a good host would make quite certain in every instance that the invitee is not embarrassed by being given the wrong drink, a false
Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
I would agree, Peter. It's not very quiet, hasn't it?
Yes, it is. Beginning to drag, I thought, as well.
20 seconds, starting now.
Well, the duties of a host are manifold. They involve, they're endless. You've got to put them into bed, you've got to take books, you've got to give them drinks, then you've got to take...
Aimi MacDonald challenge.
You don't have to put them into bed. They go into bed by themselves.
Not all of them.
I don't think he was deviating from the subject of the duties of a host, and there are 6 seconds left, starting now.
My advice is to leave a timetable beside the bed so that there's no mistake about the time that they're expected to leave.
Well, Peter Jones bought this... that round and this week's contest to an end with style and panache. He got a point for doing so, and it now is up to me to give you the final score. And only 1 point separates all four contestants. You'll be surprised to hear that Clement Freud was actually in fourth place, but only 1 point behind Peter Jones, who was 1 point behind Aimi MacDonald, who was 1 point behind this week's winner, Kenneth Williams. Well, Kenneth showed his manifold talents and won handsomely, and it was a popular win. We hope you've enjoyed the show this week and want to tune in again same time next week. Till then, from all of us here, goodbye.
Present Kenneth Williams, Peter Jones, Derek Nimmo and Sheila Hancock in just a minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you very much. Hello and welcome to Just a Minute. They're all going to try and speak as usual, if they can, for 60 seconds on the subject that I will give them, and they will also try and do it without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject on the card. And we begin the contest this week with Peter Jones, and the subject, Peter, is bugling. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
We hear a bugle call from the barracks near our house at 6 o'clock every morning and at the same time in the evenings. I don't know what company it is.
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
Repetition of in the, in the.
What a mean little challenge so early in the show.
That's right. It is mean, isn't it?
And I remember a few weeks ago you were really blowing your top about someone challenging for
Yes, you're not like an elephant in that sense.
And you always say, let each person get underway with this subject before a challenge, so I don't think I'm going to allow it and say that Peter can keep bugling starting now.
Those wonderful sisters, Patty, Laverne, Maxine, used to sing about the bugle boy, I remember, when I was comparatively young.
Kenneth, William challenge?
Hesitation.
Yes, I agree with that one, Kenneth, and you have a point there for a correct challenge, and you take over the subject of bugling, and 40 seconds are left, starting now.
Bugling is a great art, and the secret of successful bugling lies... Who challenged?
Sheila Hancock.
But I think it's absolutely disgraceful. I come here, a noted luminary, and I'm treated. It is ludicrous.
He's yes, having the jib jam.
You are actually known the BBC as the ludicrous luminary.
You're giving this character.
So, Sheila, you have a correct challenge for hesitation. You have a point and the subject, and 32 seconds are left. Bugling starting now.
Bugling is something that gives me great pleasure. I think on the Remembrance Day services in little villages, occasionally you'll have a bugle call doing the last post, and there is nothing more evocative and moving than that. Also, Boy Scouts, when they first learn this instrument, can be a very touching sight. Their first attempt at music.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of first.
That's right, Derek. And 8 seconds of effort.
I don't think Boy Scouts blow the bugle anyway.
they do try. 8 seconds, bugling, Derek, starting now.
Bugling, it's a very ancient art. It goes right back to Roman times, because the very first bugles were made from ram's horns, and that is why...
When in Messiter blows his whistle, it tells us that 60 seconds is up, and whoever is speaking in that moment gains an extra point, and it was on that occasion Derek Nimmo who has the lead at the end of that round. And Derek, will you begin the next round? The subject, Fiddlesticks. Can you tell us something about that in 60 seconds, starting now?
Well, actually, of course, the word fiddlesticks has a frightfully rude derivation because it rarely meant the male member. And that is why Shakespeare, in one of his lines, which we all remember so hugely well, talks about a man riding on his fiddlesticks. And that, I think, is quite disgusting because it's like those spherical objects which we mention sometimes when we meet rubbish. And that's why fiddlestick means something equally the same. And I find it awfully difficult to talk about such a disgusting, disgraceful subject as fiddlesticks.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Repetition of disgusting.
Yes, it was, wasn't it? And you are correct, Peter, and you have 34 seconds on fiddlesticks, starting now.
Well, I can only assume there's something to do with playing the fiddle, those things that you attach, you know, horsehair.
Kenneth Williams.
I thought hesitation.
And you thought correctly, and there are 27 seconds on fiddlesticks, starting now.
Then, like all other words which become corrupted over the years and we lose sight of the original intention of the coiner, I believe is the correct word for the etymological source.
Sheila Hancock, challenge.
Do you repeat word?
Well, you don't know what your challenge is, dearie. You shouldn't make it at all.
Well, I just thought I'd make my presence felt.
Yes, with the usual presumption of your sex, you see.
She said
presumption.
You shouldn't have women
on
this
show. No, they shouldn't have women on this show. It's disgrace.
Kenneth, well, you keep the subject, and there are 15 seconds left on fiddlesticks, starting now.
Fiddlesticks, as, of course, Mr. Jones has said earlier on in this...
Peter Hancock, Charles.
Well, he's about to repeat it. I mean, if Peter's already said it, why should he repeat it?
Because he can repeat it as long as Peter doesn't repeat what he said in the round.
Oh, well, in that case, you could just say exactly what the person before you said.
You can.
You must change the rules. I mean, it would make for a very boring game if I just did exactly what the person before did.
Well,
it's often boring the first time, but that.
I just want to give Kenneth another point. Go on.
Yeah. So, Kenneth, you give me another point. Fiddlesticks, 10 seconds, starting now.
These were small pieces of wood placed between... Oh, dear.
Sheila Hancock.
Deviation, hesitation, and everything else.
Well, I'll give it to you on one of them, and you have 8 seconds on fiddlesticks, starting now.
I wish there was something that stuck fiddles, because my daughter's just broken hers, and it's going to cost a fortune to replace it. You would not believe...
So Sheila Hancock was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point, and she's now in second place, but you'll be delighted to hear that Kenneth Williams is in the lead at the end of that round.
No.
So all that fiddle sticking has taken him into a commanding lead of one. Kenneth, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is Burns. Will you tell us something about that subject in 60 seconds, starting now?
Well, he was a very great poet, born near Ayr, as a matter of fact, in a very ordinary sort of schooling. No one would have dreamed at that period that he was going to flower into this great native genius of...
Sheila Hancock, challenge.
Repetition of great.
Yes, I'm afraid there was, Kenneth. Sheila, you've got in well with 47 seconds to go on Burns, starting now.
It's very interesting. I always thought that for a burn, you had to put on something greasy. And I think a lot of people believe this. In fact, of course, it is the absolute opposite.
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
Repetition, two things.
Yes.
I used to think, and a lot of people think.
Yes, you're right, Kenneth. I had to think for a moment.
Oh, dear,
to think if
keep
you
on jogging your memory, don't you? Have you ever got the job as chairman? I don't know.
I think they were pretty desperate at the time.
Yeah, they
I have to think about...
Can we put that to the audience?
No, I don't think I'll risk it. Kenneth, there are 37 seconds on Burns starting now.
He wrote, "Ah, woods and power, the giftigius, to see ourselves as others see us." What wisdom in those lines! I have that capacity myself because I have what you call self-awareness, the second sight, the sixth sense, if you will, of being able to be objective about the persona you yourself embody.
Sheila Hancock Challenge.
Deviation, is this truly about Burns? I think he's talking about his own.
I think he's talking about Kenneth Williams now, not about Burns.
Yes.
He told me once he brought himself into it, he couldn't get off the subject, could he? for the sake of our listeners, Kenneth Williams has now put his arm round Sheila Hancock.
Oh, dear, I've never sat next to him on this programme. It's very disconcerting.
I know.
No wonder Clement's so
odd. He's now going to try and inhibit you all the time. Well, he's now going to try and nobble her or unsettle Sheila as she talks on the subject of Burns with 14 seconds to go, starting now.
In the interests of public safety, I will continue what I was saying, that in fact, of course, what you do is to put the burn under cold water to bring the temperature down, I suppose, and then call an ambulance or help as quickly as you can.
However, please don't take medical advice in just a minute. No. If you're unsure, do consult your doctor.
On the contrary, that was very sound advice.
Is that right?
Very sound. She endorsed exactly what I was told by a specialist at Bart's Hospital, one of the most brilliant men who's concerned about that kind of thing. And she endorsed it, and she couldn't have put it more eloquently. In fact, I couldn't have done it better myself. That's saying something.
That is.
Sheila Hancock was speaking as the whistle went, and she had that extra point, therefore, and she's now taken the lead ahead of Kenneth Williams. And Sheila, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is winning, and you're in a winning position at the moment. So will you talk on the subject just a minute, starting now?
I have a deep instinct to want to win. I think it was ingrained in me by my father, who, when I used to come home from school and say I was second in an exam, would always say, "Who was first?" And I then decided that that was the thing you should be. But I now believe that that is a stupid way to face life. My daughter, whom I brought up quite differently, seems to me to be a much nicer person because she hasn't got this striving ambition to be top all the time and has much more respect rather than envy for the people who beat her. However, on this game, I do sometimes feel I want to win because the boys are so rude to the guests and sometimes they are so arrogant and frightening and they use all sorts of ploys to put you off. So therefore, it is a feather in your cap if you can actually keep talking for five.
Peter Jones is challenged.
Just putting another feather in her cap. Just, I thought I'd give another point, you know.
But the audience... I realise what you were doing. An incorrect challenge, so Sheila gets another point to help her winning position. And
how long have I got to go?
You've got 2 seconds, having taken some charity, on the subject of winning, starting now.
I have winning ways when I...
So Sheila Hancock took the subject of winning and most eloquently, I thought, kept going for 58 seconds. She was interrupted, so she got another point, and she's increased her lead into a more winning position than before. Derek Nimmo, your turn to begin, and the subject is how to encourage Salmonella. 60 seconds starting now.
Hang on, I'm going to write it down.
Hesitation, well
no,
done.
Well, I mean, Salmonella, right, OK.
The subject, Derek, is...
I suppose in case you forget the subject while you're talking about it.
Yeah.
You write it down. Is that... Probably I ought to do that.
Derek Nimmo has now written the subject down. It is how to encourage Salmonella, and he starts now.
To leave lots of bits of meat outside, and they can go all mildewy, mutty, disgusting, cover them with bugs and rubbish, shove them in bins, and then stuff them into Kenneth Williams' mouth, and he'll choke and groan, and with any luck at all, he'll develop Salmonella, and we'll rid him from this earth once and for all, and we'll never have him again playing this game of just a minute.
Sheila Hancock has challenged you.
Yes, Sheila.
Well, I think it's singularly nasty and devious to talk about Kenneth like that.
Thanks.
However, apart from that, I don't think you develop salmonella yourself. That's not what you get. You get food poisoning as a result of salmonella, don't you? Isn't salmonella the squiggly things that grow on the food?
Well done,
that
Sheila.
Give you the food.
Marvellous. Well, yes, congratulations.
Thank you.
Nice to have intelligent people on the programme, isn't it? How to encourage salmonella.
How to encourage salmonella.
32 seconds are left for you to talk on it, starting now.
Well, I would say, salmonella, pull yourself together. Come on, girl, you can do it. I believe in you, salmonella. There's nothing you can't do if you attempt it. The world's your oyster, salmonella. I am encouraging you to succeed, to win against Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones and Kenneth Williams, salmonella, because I believe in you. I've said that before.
And Derek Nimmo has challenged, yes.
Well, no repetition.
Yes, there are 6 seconds left for how to encourage salmonella, Derek, starting now.
Oh, it was me. Oh, yes, salmonella. Well, I think one should encourage it, because sometimes when it begins to grow within...
So Derek Nimmo got a few points in that round. He's pulling up now. He's in third place, just ahead of Peter Jones. Kenneth in third, and Sheila Hancock still leading in a winning position. Kenneth Williams, your turn to begin, and the subject is Pisciforms. Can you tell us something about those in just a minute, starting now?
Pisciform simply means relating to the species of woodpecker birds. I don't see anything particularly interesting about that at this audience. I don't think they would give a damn about woodpeckers at all. I don't think they care.
Sheila Hancock, challenge.
Oh, fool that I am. Repetition of woodpeckers.
Yeah, there were two woodpeckers there.
Why would you talk about pisciforms?
So Sheila Hancock is 49 seconds left. She's going to try talking on pisciforms starting now.
Well, it's obviously derived from the Latin pisces and
formus,
meaning a type of fish.
Doesn't mean that at all.
Kenneth is absolutely wrong. Woodpeckers don't enter into it. Has anybody challenged me?
She's wrong. It's nothing to do with Pisces. It does mean relating to woodpeckers.
You're perfectly right. Yes.
Thank you.
So you have the subject back.
Oh, thank
you. And there are 35 seconds on pisciforms, starting now.
One of the men who was, I suppose, the most authoritative expert on the subject said, what a wonderfully readable, drinkable, feedable, follow my leadable, this happy, breedable, oh, yes, indeedable century this pisciform era has been. And what he meant was that the very pecking act itself, because don't forget, they are getting insects out of the bark in the process of doing this thing I've just discussed already and don't want to say again, lest these dreadful people...
Peter Jones has challenged.
Musgarvan 3, chica legaragio e umbrously crackly.
I would agree with that, Peter. Wholeheartedly, yes. Very good impersonation as well. So, deviation.
Yes, deviation.
7 seconds starting now.
These wretched woodpeckers live on insects and they have to rattle them out of the bark of the tree and...
I've just said all that. We don't want to hear it again.
These people are nodding off. He's so bored, he's dropped off. Look at him. Don't want to hear all this rubbish again. He doesn't know what to say. He's only doing his buzzing to try and score points. That's all he's
doing. Yes, I know, it's a strange thing. There wouldn't be a game if they didn't do that. Peter, an incorrect challenge, because you can repeat what someone else has said, but not what you said yourself. 2 seconds are left. Pisciform starting now.
Lacking an electric drill, the only thing it's got is a beak.
Well, now we have the situation that Peter Jones has pulled up into second place alongside Kenneth Williams, overtaking Derek Nimmo, but Sheila Hancock still in the lead, and Sheila will begin the next round. And the subject is the greatest woman who ever lived. I'm sure you've got some ideas on that, Sheila. Can you talk about it in just a minute, starting now?
Well, this was a lady called Trudy Stevens, who weighed about 28 stone. When she was born, she was perfectly normal, but she ate an awful lot of food as life went on, maybe because she was a bit miserable or something, and gradually she put on weight until she became the greatest woman in the world. It had some disadvantages, inasmuch as she couldn't buy clothes to fit her, and it was difficult getting through the average doorway or sitting in a seat at a theatre, but somehow she managed, and eventually she went into a circus and became exhibited as the greatest woman in the world. And people paid good money to go and have a look at her, and I'm talking a load of rubbish.
Okay,
Kenneth Williams, a sporting challenge, yes.
Yeah, that voice was rather running out of steam, so I tell you.
She was, she more than hesitated.
But I was so ashamed, because it's all lies.
But you did keep going with 49 seconds. Bad luck, Sheila. But Kenneth will now tell us something about the greatest woman who ever lived, starting now.
This unquestionably was Helen of Troy, who, as you know, caused a thousand...
Sheila Hancock, Charlie.
It's deviation, because it's not unquestionable, is it?
In his mind, it is. You question it, but it's his mind, and it is not deviating from the subject on the card. So whether you can disagree, but he wasn't deviating. So 5 seconds left on the subject, Kenneth, starting now.
Sheba still turns her head for the sound of great Solomon. Judith is dressing the bed.
So Kenneth Williams got a number of points on that round, including the one for speaking as the whistle went, and he's only one behind our leader now, Sheila Hancock. Peter Jones, your turn to begin, and the subject is motorway food. Will you tell us something about that? It's got a reaction from the audience already. Starting now.
I don't think I'd be able to talk about it any more than I could eat it without repeating myself. I do think it's appalling, the stuff they serve up to people who are more or less a captive audience. They've no choice unless they drive off the motorway, which is a good idea, actually. There's no need to hurry. Go on a side road where you may find a friendly little pub or other restaurant, cafe, pull up
Eric
for Carmen.
He's now talking about food to be found on the highways and little side roads. He's not talking about motorway food.
Yeah, I don't think you gave him time. He'd only just gone off the motorway, just literally a few seconds before. If he'd gone on much longer on those byways and sideways, then I would have agreed with deviation. But no, Peter, you have the subject still, and there are 37 seconds, 38, starting now.
Whereas on the motorway itself, they are serving wet vegetables that have been grossly overcooked and ghastly hamburgers, which really bear no relation at all to the minced beef products that they should be, because they've got a lot of foreign matter, salmonella very often, I dare say, in them. And the chips have been hot for days at a time. I figure that they make them on a Monday and they're still serving them.
Deviation, they've been cold for days at a time.
I can't hear you, Derek, sorry. Peter, I think you still have the subject, and there are 13 seconds left, starting now.
The sandwiches have to be seen to be believed. They are wrapped in cellophane, or some modern equivalent, and they, too, have been prepared at some distant spot, probably...
So, Peter Jones started with motorway food and, in spite of interruptions, finished with motorway food, but it did mean he got a number of points on the way. He's still in third place, but only one behind Kenneth Williams, who's only one behind Sheila Hancock, and it's Derek Nimmo's turn to begin. The subject is just desserts. Following the motorway food, rather apt. And there are 60 seconds for you to try and talk, and Derek, starting now.
I think probably... of all the deserts that I've been to, the Karoo is the most interesting. As one goes...
Sheila Hancock, Charlie.
No, it's not even spelt the same, is it? Deserts. No,
spelling has got nothing to do with it. It is pronunciation. And I did say just desserts and not just deserts. So Sheila Hancock's challenge was correct.
Just desserts, the same spelling, isn't it?
No, but it doesn't... It isn't the spelling. You don't say the Sahara desert, do you? You say the Sahara desert.
Yes, it's very sandy.
So...
few dates with sand.
So it's not the writing or the spelling, it is the pronunciation. And Sheila, you have the subject with 53 seconds left, just desserts, starting now.
Well, I am only really cooking...
Kenneth Williams.
Hesitation, I thought.
Yes, I think you're right.
Not cooking with gas.
Just desserts he was cooking there. There are 49 seconds left on just desserts, Kenneth, starting now.
Just desserts are seldom given to those who properly should incur them, those who say motorway food, talking rubbish, since motorways never get hungry and wouldn't want to.
Sheila Hancock, John.
Repetition of motorway.
Yes, motorway, not the subject, it's just desserts the subject, and Sheila has it back, and there are 37 seconds, starting now.
Just desserts are the things that I cook best, because I'm rather frightened
end of the main course, so I am inclined to make the odd trifle or fruit salad or meringue gâteau or glacé cake or ice cream blancmange.
Kenneth Williams has
about 5 hours. You're often rowing a boat.
Oh, this is a rotten game,
Ralph. I nearly put my own beer.
So we don't want 5 oars in just a minute, do we?
That's right.
So there are 17 seconds left for you to talk on just desserts, Kenneth, starting now.
They should come to those who transgress. And when Napoleon got his eye, read it in the history book, was delighted. The same with Adolf Hitler, the same with the...
And the same, the same.
Five seconds. You know.
Just dessert, Sheila. 5 seconds, starting now.
Jellies, lychees, peaches and cream, bananas...
Well, Sheila Hancock, cleverly going with just desserts, got her just desserts by increasing her lead at the end of the round. And Kenneth Williams, your turn to begin. The subject, map reading. Can you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
If you understand the signs, then it is all right. You will know what the contour shading stands for and understand as you approach.
Sheila Hancock.
Understand?
Yes, I'm afraid so, Kenneth. 47 seconds, map reading, Sheila. Starting now.
I seem to do most of my map reading in the car with an irate husband driving, and I can never read without my glasses, which I seem to invariably have forgotten.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of C.
Yes. Well done, Derek. 35 seconds on map reading, starting now.
I first learned to read maps when I was in the Wolf Cubs, and I got a badge to prove that I could read maps. And I found it the most interesting thing, and I've gone through life, I look through them like books, and I watch and see where the trees grow, where lakes are to be found, squares with a cross on top mean churches with a tower, circles mean something similar with a spire. And if you have good maps to...
Peter Jones.
Well, I have to, against my better judgment, perhaps, interrupt, because he did repeat mean, you see. But then I wouldn't normally have objected to that, but he had it previously objected to Sheila saying seem twice.
So why
although it's a very
preamble?
Small word. Well, because it seems rather fiddling.
You put the absolute mockers on the whole show now. They've got as dead as anything.
I don't think you ought to bring religion into it.
Peter, you challenge for repetition, and I agree, and there are 13 seconds for you to talk on map reading, starting now.
Yes, in the car, that's the usual place that people indulge in this, and believe me, it can break up practically any partnership if you do it for any length of time and you don't know where you're going. Whoever is driving...
So that loud whistle then by Ian Messiter tells us that not only is the end of the round, but also the end of the contest. So to give you the final score, Derek Nimmo, who has triumphed more than once in this game, came this time only in fourth place, but that's the luck of the draw. Peter Jones, who's also triumphed, came in third place. Kenneth, who occasionally triumphs, came in second place. And Sheila Hancock, who only plays the game very occasionally, has once again completely triumphed and is our winner this week. So when we think back to what she had to say about winning earlier on, we realise how apt it was. We congratulate her. Lovely to have her on the programme. Lovely to have the boys sometimes too. And lovely to have the audience in the studio. But most of all, it's lovely to have the people who tune in and listen to Just a Minute. And we hope that you'll want to do it again at the same time next week when once again we take the air and we play this game. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch. We present Kenneth Williams, Clement Freud, Derek Nimmo and Barry Criers in just a minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello and welcome once again to Just a Minute. And we welcome back to the programme as our guest, Barry Criers. Barry, who won his Spurs competing against our three regulars in the last series, has come back to try and take them on at their own game that they play so well. And they're going to try and do it once more, speaking for just a minute on a subject that I will give them without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. And we begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo. And the subject is my resolution for this program. Can you talk on that, Derek, in just a minute, starting now?
My resolution for this program is to try to be a tiny bit amusing, slightly informative, but above all, to berate and abuse our totally inept chairman, with whom I have suffered many years, and find him getting increasingly tetchy, boring, and elderly as the years wander by. If I can achieve this great aim, and my resolution for this program, as I say, is to be ghastly and nasty to Nicholas Parsons, then I will leave this hall tonight a happier man. Because no greater joy can anybody give anyone than to be beastly to the horrendous NP. Even his wife doesn't care for him anymore. His children have long since fought against him, and I do think that he ought to be exposed. All very well, the Professor Blunts and people in this world being held up to ridicule, but this chap I'm talking about, he should be held up to the full glare of public gaze, so we can all see what a snivelling wretch that he is. And I hope...
Would you like to clear the audience? There's one waiting outside to come in. Fancy applauding that diatribe. That disgusting, unbelievable nonsense. Derek Nimmo has minus 2 points to start the program. And he kept going without being interrupted, because they were utterly amazed, my other three friends on the program, that anybody could speak in such a manner. But according to the rules of the game, he must be awarded a point for speaking as the whistle went, and also a bonus point for not being interrupted. Why should you get any bonuses for that? I've no idea. So we carry on with Clement Freud, and the subject is jogging. Clement, can you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
I'm not much of a one for jogging, because I take my exercise visiting those friends of mine who jogged and landed up in hospital. Many staircases and corridors have I trodden in order to visit these sad...
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
I thought hesitation.
You thought correctly. Kenneth, you have a point for a correct challenge. You take over the subject of jogging. And there are 43 seconds left, starting now.
I have done a bit of jogging. I do it in Regent's Park, as a matter of fact, and some very interesting people have jogged alongside me. And I must say, it's been a revolutionary occurrence in my own life, because I was always holding forth about the disadvantage of such activity. Now, 6:30 in the morning, to be jogging and seeing the sun come up over the post office tower.
Clement Freud is challenged.
The sun comes up from under the post office tower.
But usually...
Especially at 6:30 in the morning.
His phrase was perfectly correctly used, so he keeps the subject with 4 seconds to go on jogging, starting now.
I have a marvellous facility for jogging people's memory and saying, can you remember the occasion when...
So Kenneth Williams was speaking as the whistle went, got that extra point, and he's in the lead at the end of that round. I got a bigger round of applause when they was rude about me. Right, Kenneth, will you begin the next round? The subject is symmetry. 60 seconds starting now.
This must be ever present in that wonderful art of poetry. And was it not Blake who said, what immortal hand or eye could frame that awful symmetry? We all want to make it rhyme. That is the essence of symmetry itself. One of the finest exponents of the art, unquestionably, was Tennyson. When he writes on either side the river lie long fields of barley and of rye that clothe the world and meet the sky going down to Camelot. There the symmetry is all the most beautiful, balanced, precise nature and a delight to our ears and on the page our eyes. I said our twice, but don't put it away.
Clement Freud, you challenged.
Yes, he had.
Right, there are 6 seconds on symmetry, Clement, starting now.
2, 4, 6, 8 are what might be called non-symmetrical numbers.
So, Clement Freud got the point for speaking as the whistle went. He's in second place. Kenneth Williams is still in the lead. Derek Nimmo is still with us, and Barry Criers yet to speak.
Good evening.
Good evening. Barry, it's your turn to begin. The subject, very apt, is town criers. You have 60 seconds starting now.
If one peruses the Doomsday Book, one will find frequent mention and reference to the word or name Criers, C-R-I-E-R, of Norman origin, from which I derive my own name, and from whence comes Criers de Ville, what we would call today a town crier, a still surviving race as a tourist attraction in city and town and village and market squares. They besport themselves, clad in traditional regalia, holding a bell, and crying forth, oh yes, oh yes, the origin of this...
So, Derek
oh, no,
Nimmo.
Oh, no.
Yes, crying oh yes twice.
Yes, they do.
Around
but
it.
They do, you see.
You see, yes.
They
do. They don't go around saying oh yes twice, oh yes, yes twice. Yes. Right, Derek, you have a correct challenge. There are 27 seconds. Town crier starting now.
The favourite town crier that I have seen is the one who is the official town crier to the city of Chester. And they've had a town crier there these many years. In fact, it goes back some 432 of the aforementioned periods in time. And when he wanders out into the marketplace, he says, oh, yes, oh, ditto, quite frequent, and rings a large handbell at the same time as he shouts to people what they can see at the local theatre.
So, Derek Nimmo took the subject, kept going till the whistle went, gained the extra point, and has taken the lead one ahead of Kenneth Williams. And, Derek, your turn to begin the subject, cocktails. Will you tell us something about those in just a minute, starting now?
I do find it terribly boring to be given at a party a gin and tonic or a whiskey and soda, and it's so nice to see the return of the cocktail. Many more people seem to be constructing cocktails these days. One of the nice things about going to America...
Kenneth Williams has...
You might do all kinds of things with cocktails. You might mix them, but you wouldn't construct them. You can construct a building, but you can't construct cocktails. You can only mix them. So it's deviated.
Kenneth, you have the subject, and you have 46 seconds on cocktails starting now.
I like a Manhattan, and I've had a Bronx once or twice, but it does tend to go to my head, and they say it's an aphrodisiac. So, of course, I have this terrible fear that I will make a fool of myself and come out with some appalling exhibitionistic thing that will put everybody else off, and then never invite me to their parties ever again. So I have to be careful about cocktails. I like the stick and a bit of the cherry and the look of it generally. And I do think that Derek Nimmo has a point when he says, rightly, that these ordinary drinks are boring compared with the glamour of this mixture.
So, Kenneth Williams has retaken the lead. And Clement Freud's going to begin the next round. The subject, the average man. Can you tell us something about him, Clement, in just a minute, starting now?
The average man, almost by definition, doesn't exist. For the record, he has 1.8 children. Now, that is a fairly difficult achievement, because 2, 3, or even 4 progeny would seem like a reasonable number, but a vulgar fraction when it comes to boy or girl.
Barry Crow,
1.8 is not a fraction.
Well, Chairman. 37 seconds, Barry, on the subject of the average man, starting now.
The average man does not exist. The term is meaningless. What are the criteria for the expression? Is it to do with height, weight, appearance, psychological makeup, physical achievement, size in shoes, colour of hair, race, religion, creed, politics? These terms do not exist in an actual...
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of exists.
Yes.
Exactly.
Exactly. Bad luck.
Oh, yes.
Yes, but well tried. There are 18 seconds left. The average man, Clement, with you starting now.
Advertising agencies are always very keen to try and discover who the average man is so that they can point...
Kenneth Williams.
I forget what it was he was
Hesitation.
Hesitation.
That's right. Well
Hesitation,
done.
That's
there are 12 seconds on the average man with you, Kenneth, starting now.
Well, you've got the living proof of it with me. I am your average.
Deviation. No way is Kenneth Williams an average man.
I have, alas, to agree with Derek Minow about the most unaverage man I've ever met. But I say that as a great compliment. You needn't look like that. You're looking like a very average man now. So, Derek, you have the subject, and there are 7 seconds on the average man starting now.
In my opinion, Horace Picklewick represents for me the average man, and I saw him one day jogging round past Golden Green Cemetery.
At the end of that round, Derek Nimmo is equal in the lead with Kenneth Williams. But Kenneth's still staying there and out in front, and he's going to begin the next round. And the subject is John Hunter, the one who was born in 1728 and died in 1793. Will you tell us something about him in just a minute, starting now?
His services to medicine are too involved and indeed complicated to mention in the short span of time which is allotted to me. He did discover things like the embryology, the inflammation of the blood, and was the head of the surgical department at Barts. In the Peninsular campaign, he achieved an enormous amount, and at Belle Isle, on behalf of Her Majesty's forces, in improving the kind of treatment.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
In 1728, 1793, it couldn't have been Her Majesty's forces. His Majesty's forces. Deviation.
Rather clever, yes. It would be His Majesty on the throne then. So, yes. Queen Anne, 1714, so the Georges were there. And Derek Nimmo's got in with 19 and a half seconds to go on John Hunter, the one from 1728 to 1793, starting now.
John Hunter was married. Now, that is an interesting fact, because this musician that went to their household put to music...
An awful lot of hesitation.
Yes, hesitation, right. And you've got in with only 1 second to go on the subject, Kenneth, starting now.
He wrote about the human teeth and the incredible thing was he was head of dentist for a time.
Kenneth Williams and Derek Nimmo got points in that round. Kenneth was speaking as the whistle went, and they're still both equal in the lead. Derek Nimmo, will you begin the next round? The subject, pears. A lot of variations on that word, and will you talk about it in just a minute, starting now?
When I saw the average woman, I said, what a lovely pair. And all the advertising agencies were delighted with my remark, because from that they were able to determine the cup size for this kind of person. And other kinds of pairs which interested these people who deal in...
Kenneth Williams. Yes, that's right, Kenneth. There are 45 seconds for you to talk on the subject of pears, starting now.
They're very nice if they're done in red wine. I think they can be really delicious. And the other thing you do is add a little cream
and probably put in some sugar.
Barry Cryer has jumped.
Only a friendly inquiry. We've changed course into another definition of pears. Does that constitute
deviation? No,
because Kenneth
he's
didn't kept announce
going
he was talking
on the subject of
it
pears.
It was a lovely mental picture, but then I realised he was talking about fruit. Sorry. I apologise. Just an observation.
Don't apologise. The interruption was worth it. We enjoyed it. That's why we have you on the programme, Barry. Well done. But alas, it was a wrong challenge, so Kenneth has another point, and there are 30 seconds on pears starting now.
I know a man who pares his nails so narrowly that they do damage the cuticles, and I've often said to him, your paring is hopeless. And he said, I like to do this. Nice. I said, it's ridiculous. Because you look so awful. And people get quite the wrong impression, you see. And he said, well, it depends on what man's pairs does to his own kind of sensibilities. And I don't really concern myself with what other people think.
This is
a They didn't challenge us. They didn't want it.
I don't know what the devil you were talking about.
Neither did I.
I didn't understand any of it, David. And you did repeat and deviate, and goodness knows what.
Yes, they didn't want the subject. I've told you that's the only way you can win on this game, if they don't want it.
Well, they want it, but they don't want the subject. Right, now, you got a lot of points in that round, Kenneth, and you've gone into a very good lead. Keep it till the end, and you'll be our winner again. Clement, will you begin the next round? The subject, scope. You'll tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now.
Scope is a word which I frequently found on my children's school reports. A headmaster or other teacher would write, scope for improvement. We never actually knew what it meant. And I think, in all fairness, when I look at my sons and daughters, the...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Well, he's sort of packed up, hasn't he, really?
Yes. 40 seconds for you. Scope, Derek, starting now.
There is a lot of scope in this program for talking absolute rubbish on any number of subjects, such as jogging and symmetry, town criers, cocktails, the average man, John Hunter, who lived between 1728 and 93, and the average woman, and indeed,
Clement Freud, child.
Repetition of average.
Yes. Oh, yes. He eliminated saying 17 twice, but he got it tripped up on average, and Clement, you got in with 26 seconds on the subject of scope, starting now.
Could do better.
Kenneth Williams has
challenged. Well, this has been entirely about educational establishments. It's not been out of scope.
Well, he did establish that that was what was on the
report. He may have established it, but it's not what we're discussing, is it? We're not wanting that. I mean, just get on.
Now, I don't think he deviated from the subject.
Well, you may not think it, but I think it. And I haven't been heard of for ages. This audience wants to hear.
Well, that's the one thing I can say. When it comes to making a decision from the chair, it's what I think that goes and not what you think. Alas,
well,
for
that's
you.
Why you're so unpopular, you see.
Well, if I always did what you think, I'd be even more unpopular, and equally for any of the other three. So I disagree with the challenge. Clement keeps it. 15-second scope starting now.
Scope is also an anagram of both copes and pisco, the letter word meaning something to do with fish, while the former is the ability to carry out some function.
Kenneth Williams.
Well, we're talking not about scope now, but about fish and anagrams.
Yes, I agree with you. He was deviating now. So you've got him with 3 seconds to go on the subject of scope, starting now.
The program that gives the scope for my kind of talent hasn't been invented. There isn't a program that's been invented. He doesn't give me the right scope.
So, Kenneth Williams showed his scope in this kind of programme, kept going for those 3 seconds, got the point for speaking as the whistle went, and with other points, he's increased his lead at the end of the round, and he's going to begin the next round. And the subject is thunder. So will you thunder on in that one for just a minute, starting now?
I had to produce the sound of thunder in the theatre by rattling a sheet. It was made of some peculiar tin and an alloy added, and the sound thundered.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Revolution of sound.
Yes.
Oh, you're awfully petty, aren't you? Good gracious, I hadn't even got underway, you know.
Well, you may not have got underway, but you've got to try and get underway without repeating, and you did repeat the word sound, and there are 44 seconds left on Thunder Derek starting now.
The great god Thor, the thunderer, after whom the day of the week Thursday is named. On those great Njord...
So, his thunder ceased, and Kenneth, hesitation, 35 seconds, thunder starting now.
It has often been said of me that when I use the baritone range, there is a thunder in the voice which leaves the listener awed and full of admiration. Old Man River, wonderfully thunderous sound, which I alone, unless you count MacReady, am capable of producing. And they used to say about the times, the thunderer, and why isn't it on the bookstore?
Well, Kenneth really did thunder on then and kept going to the whistle when. Kenneth, all I can say is you've increased your lead once again. Barry Cryer, will you begin the next round? The subject, the romantic movement. Will you tell us something about that? In just a minute, starting now.
Hesitation.
Oh, shut up. Half a second, our guest, who doesn't play the game regularly...
Not even during it.
Right, Barry, you have a point for an incorrect challenge. You keep the subject, the romantic movement, and there are 59 and a half seconds, starting now.
The expression, the romantic movement, would be generally construed as referring to poets. In my case, I demean the expression by relating it to the movement of romance. In other words, the onset of rheumatism, fibrositis, and neuralgia have severely limited me in this...
Well,
you're not supposed to bang on the table because it causes it ruins the microphone.
When you trip yourself up like that, it's very difficult not to give vent to your feelings, which Barry Cryer
did. Thank you, Nicholas.
He thundered his feelings through the microphone by banging on the table. Derek Nimmo got in with the correct challenge. And Derek Nimmo, you start now.
Right. Now, the romantic... One of the most romantic movements that I ever saw was when I saw Kenneth Williams in Regent's Park jogging.
Clement Freud challenge.
I saw.
Yes, you saw too much, and there are 33 seconds left for Clement Freud to talk about the romantic movement starting now.
I sang Old Man River, but there was so much commotion.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of Old Man River.
No, it was Kenneth Williams, and it was in the last round as well.
You said it twice, then. No, Old Man River. I sang Old Man River. I heard it.
It's the Oh Yes syndrome again.
No, he didn't.
He did.
Well, you were making so much noise, I couldn't have heard him.
Well, I wasn't saying...
Stick to your guns, Nicholas. Audience. Stick to your guns.
Right, Clement, you have 28 seconds on the romantic movement. Starting now.
A long way from the romantic movement comes our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Kenneth Williams.
Deviation. Nicholas Parsons has nothing to do with the romantic movement.
This is one of those things I obviously can't judge on, so I'm going to let you be the deciders if I've anything to do with the romantic movement. And if you agree with Kenneth's challenge, you cheer for him, and if you disagree, you boo
exactly
for me, and you all do it together now. Oh, I'm overwhelmed. I'm something to do with the romantic... No, it's not. What's that? No, not. Kenneth Williams said has nothing to do with the romantic movement. You agree with Kenneth, so he has
the... He's just gaga.
Yes.
Rambling on. Doesn't listen to the questions anymore, let alone the answers. So what's going on?
And after having sat with you, Paul, for as long as I have this evening, I'm entitled to be gaga. So there we are.
Repetition.
Thank you. Who said yes? Bless you, darling. Join the clan. Kenneth, you have a correct challenge according to the audience.
And you have 23 seconds on the romantic movement starting now.
It was very much a reaction to the 18th century and the age of reason and was epitomized in poetry, unquestionably, by figures like Byron and Keats and Shelley. "Hail to thee, blithe spirit," he wrote. And when you think of those lovely lines, "We'll go no more a-roving."
So, Kenneth Williams took the romantic...
Yes, and I did a sort of nasal effect there. Did you notice?
Yes.
You noticed that?
Yes.
Because I thought it would colour it. You know what I mean?
Yes.
But it needed colouring. You know, because your voice is so dreary, Parsons. It's just dreary. They wanted a bit of colour, you know.
I was just about to make a very nice comment. The only man I know who can make the romantic movement sound good down his nose. So, let me now give you the final score, because we have no more time to play, just a minute. Let me tell you that our guest, Barry Crowe, in spite of the tremendous value he contributed to the programme, did finish up in fourth place. Well done, Barry. Congratulations and bad luck.
Thank you, sir.
Derek Nimmo, in spite of the revolting remarks he makes about the chairman, who is consistently fair and kind... finished up in third place with a lot of points. He was just behind Clement Freud, but there's no doubt about it, way out in the lead was this week's winner, Kenneth Williams. I must explain to our listeners...
Don't explain nothing,
I must explain to our listeners that if they thought the cheer for our winner this week was out of all proportion to the usual cheer that our winner gets, it was because Kenneth Williams left the platform and joined the audience to lead the cheering. He did it magnificently. He's going to bring the same audience in when he plays again. And we hope that our listeners will want to tune in again at the same time to hear us play the game. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The program was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch. Present Kenneth Williams, Peter Jones, Derek Nimmo and John Junkin in just a minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello and welcome once again to Just a Minute. And as you've just heard, we welcome John Junkin as our guest this week to play with our three members. John, who has excelled in so many shows on radio, is now going to pit his wits and his dexterity with words against our three regular exponents of this impossible game. And as usual, they're all free to try and talk for just a minute, if they can, on the subject that I will give them, and try and do it without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. And we begin the show this week with Kenneth Williams, and who better? And the subject is getting a good start. So, Kenneth, a good start, a good subject to start with, and a good start for the show, with 60 seconds to go, starting now.
What immediately springs to my mind is the training I underwent in the army, and an assault course was presented to us. And believe me, we had to get a good start.
John Junkin has challenged.
Hesitation, I think.
Oh, no.
Believe me, we...
It's unbelievable. Again!
Had to get
again! It's not even on the show regular. Yes. And he accuses me of hesitation. There was no hesitation there at all. Not whatsoever. Not one suspicion was there.
I dozed off in the middle of one of the pauses.
If we challenge for such small hesitations, I think we'd never get going at all, John.
I think, John, you should make allowances for his curious delivery and, of course, his age.
Provided, Nicholas, you remember that when it's my turn to speak, I shall...
You do whatever you like, John, and I will try and judge, and I have impossible decisions most of the time.
Do whatever you like, preferably shut your mouth.
And you'll get a lot of that, I'm afraid, if you sit next to Kenneth Williams, which you are doing. So, Kenneth, I disagree with the challenge, and you have a point for that. And if you're ready to go, there are 46 seconds on getting a good start, starting now.
I obtained this by persuading the sergeant who cycled along watching the progress of each soldier to let me go on his crossbar. And I got a better start than anyone else and came, of course, first, which is the proper position for a great luminary like myself. Someone who is above the herd. Egregious, perhaps, is the word for those who need to get
Peter
a good
Jones
start.
Has challenged.
Repetition of word.
Yes, yes, indeed. And deviation, he's got off the good start onto himself. 20 seconds are left for you, Peter, with a point for a correct challenge. To talk on the subject of getting a good start, starting now.
When I think of some of the distinguished members of my profession...
John Junkin has challenged.
Deviation, hesitation, repetition, total arrogance, and I don't like his shirt.
Try, which the audience appreciated. Totally incorrect on every count.
Shirt doesn't count on the radio.
You don't even dare wear that shirt on radio.
Well, Peter Jones has got his radio shirt on and he wasn't guilty of anything she accused him of. So, alas, he gets another point, but nice to hear from you, John. 17 seconds, getting a good start, Peter, starting now.
And in all seriousness, I can say that when I went to the Garrick Theatre, is it really 2 decades ago, and saw a show called Share My Lettuce, with a person I thought was perhaps one of the most remarkably gifted performers I had...
Well, Peter Jones kept going until the whistle went, which tells us that 60 seconds is up, and whoever is speaking at that moment, I need to remind you, gets an extra point.
I knew Kenneth wouldn't interrupt me.
For those of you who live abroad particularly and don't know that Share My Letters was a show in the West End in which Kenneth starred, it was just a little over 2 years ago. And I thought it was the Duke of York's as well, so you're deviating quite a lot. Which one was it, Kenneth?
It started at Eric Hammersmith, it went to the Comedy in Panton Street, and then it went to the Garrick Theatre. But I don't want this programme to sound like an advertisement for myself.
No, that would be so unusual, wouldn't it? So, let us go back to just a minute. Peter's in the lead, Kenneth has a point, and Peter Jones, your turn to begin. Would you talk on the subject of Joseph and Etienne Montgolfier, starting now?
They must be those two Frenchmen who more or less invented ballooning with very nicely decorated spheres which were propelled by hot air. And without them, I should think that the manufacturers of table mats would have been hard put to it to stay in business, because they have decorated the surface of these...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of decorating.
Yes, you had decorated before, Peter. Derek, you have the subject. You have 42 seconds on Joseph and Etienne Montgolfier, starting now.
Luckily, their father, or I suppose one might say their père, was in fact a manufacturer of paper, and so therefore they had a plentiful supply of this stuff to set fire to, which would blaze up underneath the cradle, and up into the air went the balloon and travelled for a distance of some 6 miles.
Peter Jones was challenged.
It didn't blaze up under the cradle, otherwise they'd been burnt.
Well challenged, Peter. There are 24 seconds for you on the subject, starting now.
They used to soar over the rooftops of Paris and were pictured by many of the famous artists of the day. Of course, it was much too early for Sarah Bernhardt to take a trip with one of them, but she did later in another type of model.
John Junkin has challenged.
Deviation. If she didn't go up with them, then why is she entering into this discourse?
Good challenge, because she was on another type of model which wasn't the Montgolfier one. So, John, you have at last the correct challenge.
Good Lord, I don't know what to do with it.
I'm sure
you could, but not on radio.
He sitting next to Lumarin and now got a correct challenge. There are 8 seconds for you to talk on Joseph and Etienne Montgolfier starting now.
Joseph and Etienne Montgolfier.
Yes, of course it was, but as he's a guest, I'm not going to allow it. So he gets a point for that. There are
I didn't even
seconds.
Hear what he said. What did he say?
Hesitation.
Hesitation?
Yes, it was much longer than the ones you challenged Kenneth
I've got
for.
This physical defect. I have to breathe in before I can breathe out.
So if you can keep going for 7 seconds without doing that, you start... Now,
Joseph and Etienne Montgolfier, the famous balloonists, are two people regarding whom I have virtually no knowledge.
So, John Junkin, having at last got in on the subject, kept going to the whistle wind, gained the extra point for doing so, and is actually in second place at the end of that round. Derek Nimmo, will you begin the next round? The subject, bath. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
On Tuesday, the 14th of February last year, I received the most unusual invitation by the Bishop of Bath and Wells, who asked me to go round his palace in the moat in a boat with him, which I did. And it was quite the most lovely experience of my life to be there with the good Bishop of Bath, and I can't say the face.
Peter Jones's chat.
Repetition of the Bishop of Bath.
Yes, the Bishop of Bath can only come in once in a round of just a minute. So there are 42 seconds for you on the subject of Bath, Peter, starting now.
Early in my career, I made an appearance at the Theatre Royal, Bath, one of the loveliest playhouses in all England. I can't quite understand why I've never been invited to make a return visit, but I can only suppose...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
I can understand why.
This is rude, isn't it?
It all comes out in just a minute. Derek, as the audience appreciated your challenge, we'll give you a bonus point. We'll leave the subject with Peter.
Oh, lucky.
And he continues for 28 seconds on Bath, starting now.
And to go into the well and get a glass of health-giving water, and then later on in the evening frequent the assembly rooms where they sometimes have balls.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Sort of bore. I think he thought he made an improper remark and he stopped. Hesitated.
You're absolutely.
No, I just thought that was what it was all a lot of.
I think Kerry was trying to convey that. He felt that your own remark, you felt, was a comment on what you've been saying.
Yes,
and, Derek got in first, and there are 15 seconds for him to talk on Bath, starting now.
Beau, Brummel, and Nash were two of the great dandies who held court in Bath during the 18th century. And when one used to go along the road to that fair city, in your coach and pair, maybe four even, then one would see in the distance the assembly room, the great abbey...
So Derek Nimmo kept going to the whistle and gained the extra point. He's had a few in that round, and he's moved forward. He's in 9 second place behind our leader, Peter Jones. And John Junkin, your turn to begin. The subject, sago. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Sago is what the starter of an athletic event, particularly track, says, having said, to your marks, get set, or occasionally at a lower class meeting, ready, steady. Following this, he does the aforementioned thing. Other people who do this are fathers irked at their daughters returning home and saying, I am expecting a child by the milkman, whereupon they will do this particular thing. Husbands who come home and discover their wives in flagranto delecti with the milkman will do likewise. Sago can also be spelt another way, which is S-A-G-O, and as such can be compounded into the most repellent mixture, which is served to unfortunate school children the length and breadth of this country as a sweet. It is not under any circumstances to be considered a pudding. It is more suitable for attaching wallpaper to the walls of your house. And I can only...
Well, John Junkin kept going magnificently for 60 seconds, and with the help and generosity of his friends here, because For those who like to write letters, we do know he repeated milkman, but we thought it was so lovely they let him go. Obviously, it's a milkman who repeats himself. John, they enjoyed your dissertation on Sago. I didn't understand a word of it, actually.
Neither did I.
You get one point for speaking when the whistle went and a bonus point for not being interrupted. So you're back in second place alongside Derek, behind Peter Jones and ahead of Kenneth Williams. And, Kenneth, your turn to begin, and the subject, Blaise Pascal. Will you tell us something about him in just a minute, starting now?
There's wonderful lines. The heart has its reasons, which occurs in the Posses. It's something which has haunted me for many years.
John Junkin.
He's got his hand over his mouth. I can't hear him.
I know he has. I can't hear him either.
Well, he could be deviating or repeating.
He could be doing anything. Let's ask the audience. Can you hear him?
No.
The audience can't hear him. Shall I ask the engineer if they can hear him at home? I can't hear the engineer, so... I don't think he's gone far enough to be deviating, so... And it's a subject he think he knows something about, so... We give him a point for a wrong challenge and tell him he has 53 seconds on Blaise Pascal, starting now.
At the age of 11, he astonished Descartes by actually mastering the 23 propositions of Euclid. The aforementioned philosopher was staggered by this and conveyed his astonishment to the boy's father. And later on, this kind of mathematical precocity.
John Junkin, you've fallen off.
No, I'm sorry, I dozed off. Accidentally.
Because you're an ignorant nit and know nothing about that, why don't you shut up and let me tell them about him? Fool! It's ridiculous that I should be subjected to this sort of thing. I'm a great luminary. I should be.
Well, you're talking a bit like one now, but before you were talking like
a somnambulant. People say, what a cult.
I know.
Yes.
You told us about this a few weeks ago.
What are you on about? I can't hear you. Do speak up.
It's very difficult to talk when you're in full swing. John, what was your challenge?
Nothing. I really did doze off and my head struck the button by inadvertence.
The audience had dozed off, but they hadn't got any buttons to strike, I'm afraid. He wasn't actually deviating.
But you can't challenge me for going to sleep during that. I mean, you can't
penalise. No, you were challenging him, actually.
No, you can't penalise me for dozing off in that, can you?
I can penalise you for anything, maybe.
I mean, your eyelids were drooping yourself, Nicholas.
I'm gone completely.
Yes.
You always have gone.
Kenneth, will you try and keep going with a little bit more of the cult and luminary qualities that you're renowned, with 26 seconds to go, starting now.
He's rationally physiologic.
Hesitate.
Yes, Peter. Peter, there are 22 seconds on Blaise Pascal with you, starting now.
If any members of the audience are interested in hearing about Pascal, it seems hardly likely that they would come to just a minute to find out. I think it's an appalling insult to them. They've come expecting a bit of entertainment.
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Repetition of come.
Yes, that's right, Derek. 7 seconds. Blaise Pascal, starting now.
In his 39 years, he accomplished more, perhaps, than any man that's ever lived. And what he found at the end was a true...
John Junkin challenged.
Repetition of he.
Oh, we don't bother with that, John.
I do.
Well, if we challenge every he, I think it would be very difficult to keep going. So no points charged. Half a second to go with you, Derek, starting
An
now.
An extreme ill health in the car.
Peter Jones is still in the lead, but Derek Nimmo is only 1 point behind now. Peter, your turn to begin. The subject, pleasure from music. Will you tell us something on that subject in just a minute, starting now?
Well, it can best be enjoyed when there's no other sound audible. It's dreadful if you have somebody talking behind you or even by your side. Even worse, I suppose, if you have someone buzzing.
John Junkin. Repetition
of even.
That's right, John. John. There are 47 and a half seconds for you on the subject of pleasure from music, starting now.
People derive pleasure from music in many different ways. There are those who can somehow derive some...
Kenneth Williams...
Two derives.
Two derives, yes, I'm afraid. 40 seconds are left for Kenneth on pleasure from music, starting now.
The pleasure I get from music emanates mainly from Schumann, whose center has a curious...
John Junkin,
hesitation.
Not quite, almost.
What almost? I said a curious stillness. What do you expect to do, elide? Is that curious stillness?
Well, I don't know how
you
slowly
do.
You can
speak
yourself. Without hesitating, and you do it. You
well, there was a problem. There was a hesitation, really, between each word. It was as though he was trying to decide whether to send a telegram.
It was almost a hesitation.
Counting them all.
There was a hesitation between each syllable on some occasions. But
yes, quite.
We'll let you have the benefit of the doubt, Kenneth, but don't go any slower. 30
with
seconds
your slipshod diction's amazing. You've got anything to say about anybody else? Is this a...
I was talking about hesitation, not diction.
You shouldn't be talking about anything. No, amazing. You can talk at all with those dentures.
What am I up to? What is it?
You are absolutely revolting.
Yes, so you are.
You
were hesitating over Schumann.
Oh, yes, that's right.
Yeah, you'll be talking about my wig and my dentures and my...
How many seconds have I got?
You've got 30 seconds. Oh, what a charming subject after what we've been talking about. Pleasure from music, starting now.
Beauty.
Pyrrhic Nimmo, Charles. Yes, that was hesitation. There are 28 and a half seconds. Pleasure from music, Derek, starting now.
One less pleasurable way is to listen to music. I think it's again sit in the park, perhaps Hyde, or even Kensington Gardens, and sit there and listen to a brass band playing.
Kenneth Williams.
Two listens.
That's right, Kenneth. 20 seconds. Pleasure from music starting now.
One thinks of the clarinet quintet by Mozart. What a beauty.
John Junkin, Charles.
I have never thought about the clarinet quintet by Mozart in my life.
Well, he said one thinks about it. He didn't say two thinks about it.
John, nice to hear from you, but he actually wasn't deviating.
It's not nice to hear from him. I wish he'd lay down. Lay down in the middle of the M1 I get lumbered with him every
time. Fairly safe in the middle of the M1.
How many seconds have I got?
Kenneth, you kicked the subject. You get a point for a wrong challenge, so I wouldn't complain too much. You're moving ahead. You're now equal in the lead with Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo. And you have 15 seconds on Pleasure from Music starting now.
Where I listen to the wonderful requiem of...
Derek Nimmo, Charles.
The wonderfuls.
Yes, you had wonderful when you were...
Well, it's a wonderful thing I'm glad it didn't get down at all. Limited interruptions is absolutely wasteful. You all know it. You just keep on picking. It's disgusting. And you're all jealous that I'm winning, that's all.
You're not winning. Now Derek Nimmo's winning.
I'm in the lead.
For the sake of our listeners who can't see Kenneth Williams, I must explain, he then was so overcome, he decided to preen himself and fell off his chair in the process. John Junkin helped him up onto his seat. So, Derek Nimmo has the subject. There are 10 seconds. Pleasure from music starting now.
Some of the greatest pleasure I've derived from listening to music is listening to the Gamelan Orchestra.
Kenneth Williams, this child.
Who listens?
What then?
Two lessons.
That's right,
one
yes.
One lesson, one listening.
There are 6 seconds.
Was it?
Oh, I beg your pardon, I do. I humbly... I humbly apologise, Derek. I hope I didn't put you off your stroke.
Where's this new Kenneth Williams sprung from?
No, he's smashing. I've always had a soft spot for him.
Will you please keep that for after the programme?
Oh, sorry.
Derek, 6 seconds. Pleasure from music starting now.
The last night of the Proms. How one used to enjoy Sir Thomas Beecham and all those fantastic people.
Peter Jones is Charlie.
A repetition of enjoy.
Yes.
And deviation. He's not old enough to have seen Thomas Beecham.
That's how little you know.
I do know.
All right. 1 second for Peter Jones on the pleasure from music starting now.
You don't get any buzzing.
The end of that round with a lot of points scored, including one to Derek, to one to Peter Jones for speaking, so the whistle went. Oh, the whistle went. The situation is Derek Nimmo's in the lead, one ahead of Peter Jones, two ahead of Kenneth Williams, and there are a few ahead of John Junkin. And Derek Nimmo, your turn to begin. The subject, Heath Robinson contraptions. 60 seconds starting now.
Heath Robinson was a cartoonist, artist, a man of wit and invention. I suppose the Emmett of his day. He died some, 20-30 years ago, I suppose. But during this time, his word, his name, passed into the language. A Heath Robinson contraption means...
John Junkin, Charlie.
Repetition of Heath Robinson.
Are you allowed to repeat what's on the card?
Are you? Nobody tells me the rules. I only came in to ask away somewhere.
Well, very few people here know the rules.
Ah. Oh, good.
John.
I'm glad you explained that to me, Nicholas. I'll go back to sleep.
Quite a few of the rules haven't yet been made.
And a lot of those that have been unmade. John, we don't charge for that, and Derek keeps the subject. Heath Robinson contraptions starting now. 45 seconds, by the way, starting now.
The sort of Heath Robinson contraption that comes to mind is that wonderful idea he had for removing prune stems from the smaller one's back. A series of engines were gathered together, motivated by steam power, and some had tiny little elves underneath the lower knots of the fourth particle underneath the side of the...
John Junkin, John.
Two underneath.
There were two underneath, John. That's a right challenge, and... that's a right challenge, I'm sorry. That is a correct challenge. It's a right challenge as well, perhaps, I don't know. There are 23 seconds. Heath Robinson contraptions starting now.
Heath Robinson, and I am speaking of Heath Robinson, the artist and inventor, and not Heath Robinson, our greengrocer, or Heath Robinson, who is a milkman I used to know in Devizes. Another Heath Robinson was the man I was in the army with. This Heath Robinson had nothing to do with the other Heath Robinsons, nor did he have anything to do with the Heath Robinson.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Well, he said anything to do with twice.
And he also deviated from Heath Robinson contraptions, because none of them have got any contraptions, the ones he made.
Well, we don't know about the man in Devizes.
Exactly. Getting on to that when you stopped me.
Well, I'm glad you didn't after that. Right, there are 2 seconds for you, Peter. Correct challenge. Heath Robinson contraption starting now.
He invented incredible things.
Peter Jones, speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point. He's now one ahead of Derek Nimmo. He's our leader, and John Junkin beginning the next round. The subject, the greatest president of the USA. I always say now, then Ian Mester.
I know you do. It's ever so boring.
It's terribly boring. But Ian Mester can't start the watch unless I do, you see, and we can't get the accurate.
What I want to know is who starts Ian Mester?
That is a very good question, and it's yet to be discovered. Letters on a postcard, please, addressed to the BBC. And any ideas, we will gladly react to. There are 60 seconds on the greatest president of the USA starting now.
This is a subject which has caused great discussion and dissension throughout the civilized world, because all the presidents from George Washington to Jimmy Carter have at one or another time been nominated for this specific title. There are those who believe that Abraham Lincoln, with his inspired Gettysburg Address, was possibly the one who should be the chief contender. There are those who believe that for sheer unmitigated...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
No, it isn't believe.
Yes, believed twice. 33 seconds for you, Derek, on the subject of the greatest president of the USA starting now.
I think possibly Washington was the greatest president the Americas have ever seen. Born of an old Northamptonshire family, you can still visit his house there today. And what is terribly interesting to think is the coat of arms of this particular group of people encompasses within it a star and a stripe, which possibly went on to be the foundation.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Repetition of possibly.
Yes. Peter, you have the subject. There are 12 seconds on the greatest president of the USA starting now.
Well, I've been thinking about this while the others were speaking, and I can't suggest anyone better for this marvellous post.
John Junkin challenge.
Hesitation.
Hesitation,
yes,
I agree.
Hesitation, yes.
John, you have 3 seconds for the greatest president of the USA starting now.
The Watergate scandal has made many people...
What a phrase on which to finish a round and, alas, finish the contest. But John Junkin said it, and the whistle went at that moment. He gained an extra point for doing so, and as we've reached the end of the show, I'll give you the final score. Kenneth Williams, who gave his usual good value, came in 4th place. He was just behind John Junkin, our guest, who did extremely well and was probably our most vociferous new guest for a long time.
Yes,
but... Derek Nimmo was a few points ahead of him, but he was 1 point behind this week's winner, who is Peter Jones. So, we come to the end of another round and another contest. and another show of Just a Minute. We do hope you've enjoyed it. We've enjoyed playing it as usual, and we hope that you'll want to tune in again same time next week when once again we take to the air and we play Just a Minute. Till then, from all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch. We present Kenneth Williams, Clement Freud, Derek Nimmo and Bob Monkhouse in Just a Minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello and welcome once again to Just a Minute. And as you've just heard, we welcome as our guests against our three regulars this week, Bob Monkhouse. Will try and fit his wits and his verbal dexterity and ingenuity and all the other things you'll require in Just a Minute against our regulars, and they will all try and talk for just a minute if they can on the subject that I will give them, and try and do it without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject on the card. We begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo, and the subject is getting sent, a thing that happens to me regularly in Just a Minute. But Derek, would you talk on the subject for 60 seconds if you can, starting now?
Fracas, Chanel No. 5, Miss Dior, Margriff, Gucci, Madame Rocca, Evening in Paris. These are some of the lovely scents that one can buy in shops today. But if you go to the village of grass outside Cannes, you will go to the lovely fields filled with flowers.
Bob Monkhouse is challenged.
This is one of the most exciting moments of my life. To be on Just a Minute and to have challenged, I can't believe I've done it.
Would you like a glass of water?
Thank you, I would very much. I do believe Mr. Nimmo said go twice.
He did say go twice. Bob, you're overcome with amazement at your success so rapidly as our guest for the very first time, and you've got the first point, and you take over the subject because you have a correct challenge, and you have 44 seconds left, getting sent, starting now.
My agent is always making sure that I am getting sent. He got me sent here to this studio tonight, and heaven knows how I...
Kenneth Williams,
deviation, that is completely untrue. I know Bob Monkhouse well, and he never goes anywhere at anyone else's bequest. He does it because he wants to do it. Nobody orders him around. Nobody orders him around. That's all rubbish.
How do you know?
A load of cobblers is giving it.
How do you
know? I've known him for years. I've known him for years, and he doesn't go around at somebody else's behest.
Well, how do you know that maybe it was at someone else's behest? Maybe.
Go on, answer. Tell the truth. Go on. Is it the truth? Have you really told the truth?
Do you tell the truth in just a minute?
Oh, well, I'm different.
No, Bob, you can keep going in any way you like as long as you don't deviate from the subject, and you weren't doing that, so that's a wrong challenge, and you have another point, and you have 36 seconds on getting sent, starting now.
Getting sent up the motorways, or getting sent up in anywhere, is not...
Derek Nimmo.
One of the most exciting moments he's ever had is packing up for the first time in Just a Minute.
Yes, Derek, a correct challenge, a point for that. 32 seconds are left on getting sent, starting now.
Now, some people in this life rather enjoy being sent up, and Nicholas Parsons is one of them. And he enjoys it, and you all cheer and call him a large banana and a major Charlie, and he beams with laughter, happy smart, because he's a sadomasochist. That's why he enjoys being sent up, and we must all the time pander this curious quirk within the parson that you see over there, because he really does like to be sent up. That is the end of the story. Ladies and gentlemen, good night.
And nobody challenged to find out whether it was true or not. Because I would have told them that I don't enjoy it. But as a chairman, I have to try and be fair and should be good-natured. It's a difficult job. Derek Nimmo, you kept going in the most rotten, revolting way until the whistle went, which tells us that 60 seconds is up. You gain an extra point for doing so, and you're equal with Bob Monkhouse in the lead at the end of that round. And Bob Monkhouse will begin the next round, and the subject is My Happiest Holiday. Bob, will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
My happiest holiday was spent at a nudist camp because I approve of nudism, except, of course, on flag days. I believe that there is nothing to be ashamed of in the human body or in mine either, for that matter, and so I like naturist colonies where men and women can go to air their differences, and where I was, naked as nature intended, in the wild woods, frolicking with my friends, the bunnies, and throwing stones at my enemies, the hedgehogs, and avoiding the squirrels because they were hoarding nuts for the winter. Everybody would have their happiest holiday if we all ripped off our clothing here in the studio and got at it, and that's a
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
Repetition of nudity.
For those of you who are not in the studio audience, I should explain that Bob Monkhouse's impassioned plea then had such effect on all of the panellists, particularly the chairman, that we all started to strip. We were saved from getting down to the bare scud by Derek Nimmo's challenge, and it was for the repetition of nudity. He's absolutely correct. He saved a lot of people in the audience from acute embarrassment. But nudity on radio, I think, is something to be encouraged. And there are 6 seconds for Derek Nimmo to take over My Happiest Holiday. That was the subject, not nudity. Starting now.
My happiest holiday was spent at Prest Atten in North Wales, and I used to go paddling every morning to gather mushrooms.
At the end of that round, Derek Nimmo was speaking as the whistle went, so he gained the extra point, and he is now in the lead ahead of Bob Monkhouse. In fact, they're the only two to score so far. Clement Freud begins the next round, and it is the subject, Advice to a 21-year-old girl. Do 21-year-olds still need advice? Anyway, Clement, would you take the subject and try and keep going for 60 seconds, starting now?
I suppose my advice to a 21-year-old girl would be to say, by now, you've probably taught your parents about the birds and the bees. They do it roughly the same way that your father and mother did it. And anything I tell you will be too late. So why don't you go out and enjoy yourself and try to avoid philological euphemism? I loathe people who look at me and say things like, you have lost a lot of hair, when they mean you are bald. Or seeing a drunk lying in the gutter. They say the poor fellow has a weight problem or a drink problem.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Too many problems.
There were too many problems. Derek Nimmo, you take over the subject. There are 20 seconds left. Advice to a 21-year-old girl, starting now.
I think the advice I would give to any 21-year-old girl is to see clear.
Kenneth Williams, challenge.
Yes, I don't. He knew what he was talking about. It's not a goyle or a gargoyle or a goyle. Frightful diction.
Kenneth, there are 16 seconds left for you to talk on the subject of advice to a 21-year-old girl, starting now.
It has already been set down by one of our greatest writers. Neither a borrower nor a lender be, and this above all, to thine own self.
Bob Monkhouse has challenged.
I've been listening to this show for 13 years, and that's repetition. He always goes on like that.
Bob, he does, but he wasn't repeating the subject on the card, which is repetition, not repeating his style, his phraseology, or his monotony. So, it's an incorrect challenge.
That's lovely, isn't it? Charming, isn't it? Nicky, how you get treated, you see?
Proud to have given
him. End up
point.
With your ego around your ankles. No. Wonderful, isn't it? Supposed to be your friend.
Kenneth.
Charlotte Bronte said, with friends like that, you don't need enemies.
Kenneth, you don't need any encouragement.
As people have said of you, you are actually becoming a cult in your own time.
That is true. I am a cult, an enormous cult. People have said that to me. You are a cult. You are. I am one of the biggest cults around. It's true. You're quite right. Quite right. It's very percipient of you to say that, yeah. Nick. That is percipient of him, isn't it?
So he's very percipient. Built up your ego again.
That's done the trick beautiful, yes. Yes.
And you have half a second to continue on advice to a 21-year-old girl starting now.
And if it's full of the life of
Kenneth Williams speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point, and he has a number as well in that round, so he's now in second place behind Derek Nimmo, and he also begins the next round. The subject is My Faults. Now, it's a difficult subject, Kenneth, because I know you believe you haven't any, but would you try and talk on the subject for 60 seconds starting now?
My faults can be listed as follows. One, I err very, very badly on the side.
Clement Freud is challenged.
Repetition of very.
Yes.
Isn't it mean? They're all booing. You heard the booing.
I know, I heard.
They don't agree with the challenge at all. It's a disgrace, isn't it? Absolutely disgrace.
Well, it was accurate, you see.
Oh, I see.
And I'm afraid that, though we're usually more generous and allow the contestant to keep going for a few moments,
no,
Clement didn't.
Going.
And there are 55 seconds. Clement takes over the subject of my faults, starting now.
Such faults as I have do not include hesitation, repetition, or deviation from the subject which I'm given in just a minute. But sitting next to Kenneth Williams does tend to bring out the worst in me. My shoes become undone, my socks crumple, my tie is crushed at the sheer joy of sitting next to one of the great cult
Derek
figures.
Nimmo has challenged. Next. Yes, sitting next. 32 seconds, Derek, for you on my faults, starting now.
I suppose if I have a fault, and I must admit to several, one of them is that I am sometimes overtly rude.
Clement Freud.
Hesitation.
Yes, Clement, you have 25 seconds on my faults, starting now.
Niggardliness. My thing has come.
For the sake of our listeners, I must explain the extra laugh came because as he was challenged, Clement Freud's buzzer came to pieces in his hand. He's now trying to put it together, and I think we'll continue with the show. No, an engineer's coming to help Clement Freud. No, but it doesn't matter. He's going to be working all through the series.
I think it's a 21-year-old girl wanting some advice.
Bob Monkhouse, your challenge, hesitation, well done. You take over the subject, and there are 23 seconds on my faults starting now.
My faults are so despicable, vile, low, that only...
Kenneth Williams.
Deviation, the root is despite, therefore it's pronounced despicable. No, you don't accent the I.
You can pronounce it any way you like
no,
in
can't.
Just
it's
a minute.
Down,
some of your pronunciations are
no,
utterly
it, on the contrary,
incredible.
On the contrary, the authority for this is Fowler in modern English usage, and he makes the point that this is a common error, and people should be, as Bernard Shaw rightly said, enlightened about it.
Well, you've enlightened them, and now let's continue with Bob Monkhouse pronouncing anything any way he wishes in exactly the same way that you do, and he has 19 seconds to continue on my faults, Bob, starting now.
I used to sellotape breadcrumbs to the windowsill and laugh.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
In Fowler's modern usage, we see tape.
Bonus point to Derek Nimmo for a very good challenge. No one gets any penalties charged.
You can't even speak properly. It's a joke, isn't it?
You keep the subject, Bob, and there are 16 seconds left. My faults, starting now.
I once sent a calendar to a convict who was serving a life sentence. How low can you get? And as a child, I was equally wicked. But can anyone among you say that you are without faults? I ask you this in all sincerity.
So Bob Monkhouse kept going to the whistle when gained an extra point and others in the round, so he's now back in second place, only one behind our leader, Derek Nimmo, and Derek begins the next round. The subject is Everest. Derek, will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Sir George Everest, who was Surveyor General of India in the 19th century, had this great mountain named after him. And I remember full well the excitement some 26 years ago. I was standing in the Mall waiting for a match of the Queen to process down it when one heard that Everest had been climbed. Edmund Hillary and Sherpa tensing were the first ones to the top. And one read about it in the newspapers that same day.
Clement Freud challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
Well, it was in the newspapers before he went to the Mall to see the coronation. Yes, we all did. It was announced at midnight.
I was there all night. Very cold and chilly and nasty.
Yes, I know.
And the only thing that came out of tears up was the news of Everest again.
Yes, wonderful.
Well, I agree with that, Derek, so you keep it. You have a point for a wrong challenge. 32 seconds are left, starting now.
Now, somehow, all the danger has gone out of climbing Everest because you can go to a Holiday Inn in Nepal and you can look across and there you can see this great gleaming silvery peak. Somehow, the mystery, the excitement, the tension, the danger and all the daring has disappeared. That's what we want more of in this country today. The challenge, the great mountains that need to be scaled and flags to be planted on the top, Union Jacks fluttering in the mountain air. That is what this wonderful sceptred isle, which we love so dearly, and Her Majesty the Queen, who reigns over us all, and I've talked about her before, so you can have that town if you like. And,
So, Derek, you deeply impressed everybody. You kept going till the whistle went, gained an extra point and increased your lead. And now we move to Bob Monkhouse. Bob, your turn to start. The subject, pitfalls for a programme chairman. Having been one yourself many times, you can maybe tell us something in just a minute about it, starting now.
I am amazed that the subject of pitfalls for a programme chairman has been raised in public on this programme, as I understood that the pitfall that we were digging for our programme chairman was to be kept a secret from him outside in Regent Street. However, as I have been chairman of programmes like The Golden Shot and Celebrity Squares, and welcomed, may I say, the...
Clement Freud challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
There can't be other programmes like Celebrity. I mean, man can only take so much.
Yes, well, they've taken a great deal of that and enjoyed it, but your challenge was much appreciated, so let me give you a bonus for that, Clement, and leave the subject with Bob Monkhouse with 40 seconds left. Pitfalls for a programme chairman, starting now.
People used to say to me, one of the pitfalls must be that you have to provide these marvellous prizes, how can you afford it? And I would reply that we had a system. We used to go to the Sale of the Century studio and mug the winners as they came out. And you haven't lived until...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition one by one.
Yes, rotten challenge.
Why is it a rotten challenge? If he says it and it's repetition...
Don't bang the table, it's dreadful. The engineers can't stand it. You start banging the table. But they can't stand it. They go, man,
it's a rotten way to treat a guest. So, but is this a correct challenge? So, Derek, you take over the subject with 33 seconds left. Sorry, 28 seconds. Pitfalls for a programme chairman, starting now.
The pitfall I'd like to provide for this special programme chairman is in the Rhondda Valley. I'd go and find a very deep mine shaft, and I'd dangle Nicholas Parsons over the edge of it on a long rope and drop him. But at the bottom, of course, I would put cushions and mattresses and have bottles of champagne awaiting him, because we do love him very much. He's a national institution like Bessie Braddock.
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation. He doesn't love him remotely.
Well, I can't judge whether Derek Nimmo loves me or not. Yeah, they wouldn't think we were friends, would they? There were 8 seconds left for pitfalls for a programme chairman, starting now.
There wouldn't have to be very many pitfalls for Nicholas Parsons to fall into, and as chairman of Just a Minute, he has given pretty good notice.
So, Clement Freud was then speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point, but he's still in third place behind our guest, Bob Monkhouse, and they're both a little way behind our leader, Derek Nimmo. Kenneth's just in fourth place, and Clement begins the next round, which is drafts. Will you tell us something about those in just a minute, Clement, starting now?
Drafts are the sort of things that happen pretty frequently in a BBC studio when people leave, as they do in this programme, and remain...
Derek Nimmo challenge. Hesitation is right. 50 seconds on drafts with you, Derek, starting now.
Drafts can mean money orders, and drafts at the Allgate pump is a way of expressing that something is completely worthless, because another meaning for the word draft is liquid.
Clement Freud.
Repetition of meaning.
Yes. Clement, you take the subject back. You have 38 and a half seconds on drafts, starting now.
Drafts is a game which you play on a board, such as you would practice chess upon. It's really very much more skillful than people think. It contains a number of pieces, both black and white, and you move them from your side to the other, whence the piece...
Nimmo chatter.
Floundering. He's floundering,
yes. Derek, 20 seconds. Drafts starting now.
Sometimes if you say he's fearing the draft, it means he's fallen on rather hard times. Things are not going terribly well. Out of luck. Bad fortune has come across this poor chap that you're...
Clement, you
yes,
Phillips.
I think I did a real hesitation there.
Yes, I think so, Kenneth. So you take the subject now of drafts with 10 seconds to go, starting now.
These are caused by ill-fitting windows and doors, and what you must do is to get a nice bit of felt, preferably done out in strips, and stick it there.
So Kenneth Williams kept going till the whistle went. He's got another point for doing so, and he's still in fourth place. But he's only one behind Clement Freud. He's only two behind Bob Monkhouse, but they're all quite a way behind Derek Nimmo. Kenneth, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is Bloomsbury. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Many a time and oft have I trod those affectionate pavements, and I mean it. They've loved me just as much as I have in turn given a great deal of warmth and love to them.
Bob Monkhouse has challenged.
I fear there's too much love coming from Mr. Williams.
Yes.
Double love, in fact.
Yes.
Love.
They've 40... loved me, and I've given love.
46 seconds for you, Bob, on the subject of Bloomsbury.
No, I said loved them, and they've given love to me. So I loved and not loved. So I didn't repeat it. That's right. Thank goodness I didn't. Oh, thank you,
it took
much.
Him a long time to work that one out, and there are 46 seconds left, starting now.
In Gordon Square there was born that wonderful creature, Virginia Woolf, who married Leonard. And we think of the guests, people like Maynard Keynes, Otline Morell, Lytton Strachey, all of whom enhanced the literary scene of their day and left us a heritage of which we have every right to be very proud indeed. As that wonderful woman said, Vanessa Bell, when a diamond falls from the sky, let us not with ill grace receive it.
So
Has that put me in the lead? Am I in the lead?
No, I'm afraid.
Has that put me up again?
You pulled you up considerably, yes. You got more points.
How far up?
One ahead of Clement Freud. But only one behind Bob Monkhouse, but a few behind Derek Nimmo, our leader. Derek, your turn to begin the subject, dog days. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Dog days apply to the warmest days of the year and are in July. It's an old Roman term, in fact, because they thought that when the dog star rose at the same time as the sun, this increased the intensity of heat, and therefore the expression dog days was born. Now, we all know that in an English clime, it's not always certain that heat or warmth will come during the dog days. But if you are outside Rome or Venice, Naples, then you can enjoy dog days as sure and as certainly as the months come round every year.
Bob Monkhouse challenged.
I think we had 2 years of that.
Yes, I'm afraid we did, Derek, so there's a good challenge from Bob there. 19 seconds, Bob Monkhouse, on dog days, starting now.
I have enjoyed dog days in such obvious places as Barking and the Peak District and at White City, where a dog once winked at me and said, I am going to win the next race. But...
Kenneth Williams challenge.
Deviation. I don't believe dogs talk to Bob Monkhouse.
Yes, but, that's...
No but about it, you silly great fool. No but. Targeting bat.
If Bob Monkhouse is a comedian and he can tell a story about a dog talking to me, he's not deviating from dog days, so he keeps the subject. And there are 5 seconds, Bob, for dog days starting now.
We all make mistakes, that's why they put rubbers on the end of pencils, and I therefore went and placed a good bet...
Bob
Lord Monkhouse, our guest, who's never played Just a Minute before, not only got the point for speaking as the whistle went, but gained a number of points in that round. And he has moved forward rapidly. He's now only one behind our leader, Derek Nimmo. And it's also his turn to begin. And the subject is the one-line gag. Bob, you know a lot about that. Tell us something about it in Just a Minute, starting now.
Low necks, are they on the way out? And never tell secrets to a peacock. You know how they spread tails. Reincarnation is a considerable surprise. Venus flytraps, do they eat the front of your trousers? It is one-line gags like these that have held back what was once a promising career. But on my way to the studios, I invariably call in at the zoo and tell my one-line gags to the hyena, which gives me a great deal of confidence. But I also have to spend money on these one-line gags because I pay a schoolboy to translate them from the original Latin. Please don't laugh at these. There are people down the front who are trying to sleep. A typical one-line joke would be the one about the female hippopotamus who is pregnant for 16 months, so there'll be no hurry with the knitting. Another one is the one about the Arab who...
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Repetition of one. Another one.
Was yes, there was a lot of ones, but what a pity.
No, I'm sorry.
Oh, one! One-line gag. I'm sorry, it's on the card.
Right you are, Derek.
He's allowed to use the word one because it's on the card, so there we are. He can keep going with another point. And he's caught you up, Derek Nimmo. There are 16 seconds on the one-line gag with you, Bob, starting now.
Is Karl Marx's grave a communist plot? Always try to be yourself, because if you are not, someone else will be. Does unabridged mean a river that you have to wade across? These are other one-line jokes which certainly should not be extended.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Repetition of jokes.
You did talk about the word jokes before. So he's got in, Derek did, with half a second to go on... Oh, yes, yes, I don't think we've got any more time. And so with half a second to go on one-line gags, starting now.
The unluckiest man... Oh.
So I think at the end of that round, as we have no more time, a special round of applause for Bog Monkhouse, because to keep going on one-line gags and demonstrate them as well as talk about them required a great deal of ingenuity and verbal dexterity. And now... to give you the final score, Clement Freud, for once, finished in fourth place, just behind Kenneth Williams. Kenneth was a number of points behind Bob Monkhouse, our guest who almost won, but not quite at the last post. He was pipped by this week's winner, Derek Nimmo. We do hope... that you have enjoyed Just a Minute, and we'll want to tune in again at the same time next week when once again we take to the air and we play Just a Minute. Till then, from all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch. We present Kenneth Williams, Peter Jones, Clement Freud and Derek Nimmo in Just a Minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello and welcome to Just a Minute. And alas, I have to tell you, this is the last in the present series of the game and of the contest. But I'm sure you're going to enjoy it because we have our four regulars, and when they all get together, anything can happen. My voice has gone already at the thought of it. Anyway, they're going to speak, as usual, if they can, on the subject that I will give them and try and do it without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject on the card. And we begin the show, this last in the series, with Kenneth Williams, and who better? Now, Kenneth has won many accolades in his time, and the subject is...
my accolade. So, Kenneth, will you talk on that subject in just a minute, starting now?
My accolade would be given for utter scrupulosity, fineness of character, and honourable and charitable disposition. And there are few people that I can think that would ever have a chance, I mean, of winning it, because, I mean, I'm demanding that.
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
Repetition, I mean.
Yes, you did say I mean before. So, Derek Nimmo, you have a correct challenge, a point for that, and you take over the subject of my accolade, and there are 38 and a half seconds left starting now.
My accolade would, of course, be given to Kenneth Williams for his generosity of nature, his high intelligence, absolute and unquestionable integrity. A finer example of British youth have I ever seen. There is a man who is at the very pinnacle of his success.
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
Deviation, I'm 53.
A youthful 53, but a correct challenge as well. So, Kenneth, you have the subject back, and there are 18 seconds on my accolade starting now.
My accolade would be definitely given for purposes of...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of given.
Yes, because you gave your accolade out.
You've got a marvellous memory, haven't you?
There are 18 seconds. Sorry, there are 13 seconds on my accolade with you, Derek, starting now.
Standing nightly in the theatre with his modesty and humility, everyone would acclaim and indeed do this extraordinary, magnificent, amazing 53-year-old who still...
Ian Messiter, blowing his whistle after 60 seconds, tells us the time is up, and whoever speaks at that moment gains the extra point. It was, of course, Derek Nimmo who has the lead at the end of the first round. Peter Jones, will you take the second round? The subject is bubbles. Will you talk on that in just a minute, starting now?
When I think of bubbles, I think of Bubbles Laverne, who was one of the best endowed and most talented of striptease dancers. She often used balloons, not actually bubbles, but, oh, at least I think they were. They were certainly inflated. And she used to blow them up and toss them around the stage, and very dexterous, very...
Yes, there was indeed. I could see in the look of his face he was caught up in the act and...
rather carried away by the memories.
That's the expression I was searching for, Peter, but well done. 30 seconds are left with Derek Nimmo on bubbles, starting now.
I always have a theory that in champagne, the smaller the bubble, the better the brew. And I think this will be supported even by Mr. Freud. Another time that I think of bubbles, when I...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of think.
Yes, right.
Well, you were told not to observe these small words. The chairman mentioned that before. He said, don't keep picking on these tiny words. Now, well, that's a very good point he's made.
That's a verb, you know. I don't know.
Yeah, they're small, piddling things, really. I mean, come on, let's have a bit of generosity of spirit. Bigger. Take a bigger attitude, a warmer, a more generous attitude. Come along.
Peter Jones.
Come along, let's be
repetition
warm.
Repetition of vigor. Yes. If we couldn't use verbs, I'm afraid it would be impossible to continue the game or even speak. So, Clement, I agree with your challenge. You have a point. 19 seconds. Bubbles, starting now.
I hardly ever think of Bubbles Laverne these days, but the word bubbles conjures up in my mind those things in cartoons which contain the words thought of by the character depicted in the picture or the strip or whatever publication you seem to have bought.
Clement Freud, speaking as a whistlewind, gained an extra point, but he's only in second place. Derek Nimmo is still in the lead, and Derek, your turn to begin. The subject, the most pleasing city I have visited. We know you've been to quite a few. Tell us about one of them, starting now.
I think the most pleasing city that I've ever visited is Adelaide in South Australia, founded by Captain Light, whose father was a colonel who started Penang for the British. It's a wonderful piece of town planning, because there in the centre of the city is a cathedral. Around that is the tennis courts, rather like Wimbledon, a beautiful oval for cricket, and I find that the mass of green around this city, with the River Avon flowing through it, is particularly...
Peter Jones has challenged.
A repetition of a round.
Yes, you had a round before, and Peter has a correct challenge, and 25 and a half seconds with you, Peter. The most pleasing city I have visited, starting now.
Well, I think the city of London, particularly at the weekend, is one of the most pleasing cities that I've visited. There are no shops open, there are very few people, and although one can get a drink at a few pubs, generally speaking...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of few.
Yes, I'm afraid that's right. 8 seconds are left on the most pleasing city I visited, Derek, starting now.
Also, there is the Arts Complex, 3 magnificent theatres with an outdoor auditorium as well, from which at night...
So Derek Nimmo increased his lead at the end of that round. And Clement Freud, will you take the next round, the subject water divining? Will you tell us something about that in the game, starting now?
I've never really understood why people should want to divine water, because wherever one goes, the stuff is thrust at one. I haven't been in a BBC studio without people giving me at least 2 jugs and a glass, in case in the middle of whatever I was going to do, I had this enormous urge to consume water. W.C. Fields has my sympathy when he explained why he did not drink, and he said it's because of what fish do in it. Actually, the...
Peter Jones has challenged.
He's talking about water, but not water divining.
I agree with your challenge, Peter. You have 30 seconds and you take over water divining starting now.
One of the most unfortunate water diviners I ever heard of went bankrupt because he kept giving his clients very bad advice, saying, drill here. They never found anything. And it was only after he would been in a debtor's prison...
Clement Freud challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, Clement.
But I just have to finish it because it's quite amusing. Really. Yes, after he was in the, after he was put in the debtor's prison, it was found he was suffering from water on the knee.
He was always getting a wrong reading, obviously. There are 17 seconds for water divining with you, Clement, starting now.
The art of water divining seems to involve people holding twigs of wood between thumb and forefinger and walking across...
Peter Jones's challenge.
No, they have to hold the twig firmly with each hand. Both hands have to be held very firmly.
That's right.
Nothing
yes.
to do with thumb and forefinger.
Yeah, quite right. Yes. Very good, Peter. Very well observed. Very good.
That really is not true. Different water diviners use different holds on the divining rod.
Yeah. And we're obviously going to get lots of letters from water diviners throughout the world on this, but...
Ask the audience. They know about things like this.
I think we'll leave it to...
Very good chairman. Yeah. He knows his job.
Is there a water diviner in the audience? No, so I had to make the decision. Peter, I agree, that's the general way of doing it, so you have the subject. There are 7 seconds on water divining, starting now.
It has to be made of hazel wood, otherwise it won't work.
Derek Nimmo, chap.
Hazel wood.
Yes, you did.
Hazel right. wood is hyphenated.
Is it?
Yes, hazel wood.
Oh, course. Thank you very much.
Like Jenny. Hazelmere.
Like Hazelmere. With your friend's help over here, you still have the subject, Peter, and you keep going with water divining with 3 seconds left, starting now.
They're not in such great demand nowadays as they used to be.
So, Peter Jones kept going to the whistle when gained that extra point, and he's now in 2nd place, 1 behind our leader, Derek Nimmo, 1 ahead of Clement Freud, and 2 or 3 ahead of Kenneth Williams. And people who live in Hazelmere, please don't write in and say you're not hyphenated. Kenneth.
Most people who live in Hazelmere are hyphenated.
Kenneth, will you take the next round? The subject is Marshal Soult. Will you tell us something about him in just a minute, starting now?
Not a very edifying picture, I'm afraid, is going to be painted of this individual. He started off, I believe, he was promoted eventually to Marshal of France by Bonaparte, and then was created after the Peace of Tilsit Marshal as well of some other thing, and then Duke of Dalmatia, and then he came to this battle, the terrible affair, Austerlitz. And then, of course, Napoleon fell from grace. Well, he went off to Elba, didn't he? And then he said, well, I'll turn royalist, you see.
So Derek Nimmo challenged you?
Three and thens.
Yes, you did have three and thens, so he let you get away with one. Derek, there are 19 seconds left for Marshal Soult starting now.
He was created Duke of Dalmatia because he was frightfully spotty, and therefore he would run round the street saying, hello, old Soulty, in a kind of disparaging sort of way. And after
Clement's word is challenged.
Two sorts.
Yes. Clement, you have 5 seconds on Marshal Soult starting now.
Marshal Soult was, of course, known as Le Maréchal in France, where he achieved high office.
So, Derek Nimmo still in the lead. Clement Freud has pulled up a little into second place, one ahead of Peter Jones, and Kenneth is in fourth place, and Peter begins the next round. Peter, the subject is the writing on the wall. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Well, I saw this poster saying, in outer space, no one can hear you scream, and someone had written underneath, but Anthony Wedgwood Benn can still be clearly heard. Now, this struck me...
Clement Freud challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
Well, it's the writing on the wall, not on a poster.
Well, the poster was on the wall.
But the writing was on the poster.
Well, I think... I think we give him a point for a very clever challenge, but he wasn't, strictly speaking, deviating from the subject. So, Peter, you have 47 seconds left, starting now.
And I often find that on the walls of different places that I visit, the most amusing comments by humorists, who are really quite inventive, like the classic one of a happy Christmas to all our readers. I always enjoy that. It comes round at least once a year. And the...
Kenneth Williams has...
Well, there was a lot of erring going on.
Yes, he was...
Hesitation.
He erred indeed there. And there are 26 seconds for you to talk on the writing on the wall starting now.
The moving finger writes, and having writ moves on. Not all your prayers...
Peter Jones has challenged.
Well, if you can't... I mean, the finger can't actually write. This is a Freud-type challenge. It has to be... It has to be holding a pen, pencil, piece of chalk, ballpoint or whatever.
If we're going to have all these kind of metaphysical challenges...
Is
I'm
that
gonna have
metaphysical?
Well, what the... I don't know, but you can't... All right, do you want the audience to judge on this one?
No, just the extra point, congratulations, and move on.
Peter, I think have a bonus point for an impossible challenge.
Well done.
Kenneth Williams keeps the subject with 17 seconds on the writing on the wall, starting now.
When something is presaged propitiously, they often say, he has seen the writing on the wall, meaning that he has gained, through this prescient nature, some indication of what will occur in time.
So much to the pleasure of our audience, Kenneth Williams kept going to the whistle, went, gained an extra point for doing so, and is still in fourth place. But he's only just behind Peter Jones, and he's only 1 point behind our joint leaders, who are now Clement Freud and Derek Nimmo. Of course, the most famous writing on the wall is the one that says, you know, my mother made me a homosexual. And underneath someone had written, if I got the wool, could she knit one for me? Derek, your turn to begin. The subject is... The subject is freeze. Can you talk on that subject in just a minute, starting now?
One watches the audience freeze with horror when Nicholas Parsons makes such unpleasant jokes as the one he's just made. I do feel his lack of taste is only surpassed by his similar
defection of talent. But I would like to say that the most beautiful frieze that I ever saw was in Herculaneum, the ancient city by Naples, on the wall of a very old house. And there was this sort of bacchanalian orgy taking place, and one could see all kinds of funny people leaping all over the place, and a lady came behind and said, "Why are those two young men playing leapfrog?" And they weren't. I thought this was during the credit freeze, then we must all rally to the government in the day and try and help.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Well, it went to pieces a bit there. No, government in the day, you know, and everything. And after the comments about your lack of taste,
yes.
I thought his own.
Not at all. That's in the eye of the beholder. It's your dirty mind. No, not at all. I've been to that city he's talking about, and I've seen that frieze that he's talking about. Very fine and very colourful it is.
Well, I...
You haven't been there. You're ignorant. You know nothing about it. Why don't you shut your mouth?
I may not have been there, but I certainly have a dirty mind.
Yes.
Constant source of pleasure and interest.
So, back to just a minute. What was your challenge, Peter?
It was a kind of hesitation.
That's a new one we're bringing in, a kind of, not
well,
an actual
yes,
hesitation.
Yes.
No, actually, he didn't hesitate, I must be fair.
He didn't?
No, alas.
Pity, really.
Yes. Pity for the rest of us, because yes. We'd rather hear from you than Derek Nimmer, obviously. But he still has... And by the audience reaction, that is endorsed. But I have to be fair within the game, and in spite of what Derek says about me, he keeps the subject with another point, and there are 5.5 seconds on freeze starting
Nicholas
now.
Nicholas Parsons, not only a freeze, but a frost.
Peter Jones' challenge.
A repetition of Nicholas Parsons.
Yes. And we can't have too much of Nicholas Parsons even in just a minute. So
We already have too much of
If the audience clap those remarks, you know I do have the power to clear the studio. Peter Jones, I'm delighted to say that you have a point for that, and Derek Nimmo has lost the subject, and you take over the freeze with 3 seconds to go, starting now.
You've often cleared halls in which you have appeared, I know that.
Yes. Derek Nimmo's laughing, and
I'm not alone.
No, but you should be. Let's give the score at the end of that round. Kenneth Williams is still in fourth place. Clement Freud is in second place, but he's 1 point behind our new joint leaders, Derek Nimmo with Peter Jones. Clement, your turn to begin, and the subject is losing. Can you tell us something about that in this round? And as we approach the end of the last of our series, losing 60 seconds starting now.
Losing is something which, as a nation, we're very good at. And, of course, losing is only a disaster if you'd set your heart on winning. In just a minute, losing is something which Peter Jones excels at. He gives amazing value for the time that he is on and amasses a minimal number of points in order consistently, or fairly frequently at any rate, to be last or in penultimate position. You lose in just a minute, which I've repeated before.
Derek Nimmo has challenged.
Just a minute.
Really. Yes, Derek, yes. You have the subject now. There are 28 seconds on losing, starting now.
I am one of the people who have lost out in life. I feel I've lived a very sheltered existence. I always wanted to win, but somehow time is passing by, and an increasing air of misery and despond fills me, particularly as I now see
Kenneth
the
Williams writing... Has
deviation. He's absolutely rubbish. He's not missed out on anything. He's sitting in one of those expensive suits. He goes around in a Rolls Royce, never stops talking about all these fascinating places he's been to abroad, and he says life's passed him by, standing right on his doorstep. Great.
Thank you. I quite agree, Kenneth. I think he passed live by so fast he didn't even see it going. So, Kenneth, you have a correct challenge and 11 seconds on losing, starting now.
This is something we all do. Since the moment you are born, you are nearer to your grave and
Clement
therefore
Freud
you
is
will...
What?
It was a petty challenge. I
know, so Kenneth Williams gets a point for an incorrect challenge.
Right.
Yes. Very petty. 4 seconds on... 4 seconds, still with you, Kenneth, on the subject of losing, starting now.
Losing has to be done, as I do it, with good grace, with charm, with ease, in a manner...
And they were very generous there. He put 4 widths in 2 seconds. But, Kenneth, you kept going to the whistle, gained an extra point, and you are now... You're now in last place, I'm afraid. But you are alongside Clement Freud, and who better? One of the great winners of the game. And you are both only 1 point behind Peter Jones, who's only 1 point behind Derek Nimmo. Isn't it exciting? Oh. Please yourselves, as they say. Kenneth. We're reaching the end of this show, alas. And what about the subject of the next series? It's your turn to begin, so will you take the subject of the next series and talk about it, starting now?
The next series carries the message, of course, of continuity and hope that all this will be sustained. But at the same time, one must admit that in discussing it, there is an awful pang, a tearing at the heartstrings, as one realizes it is for this. Adieu, auf Wiedersehen, and hang my harp on a weeping willow tree and sit upon my grandma's knee. Because that is the recipe for any series. The knee position for...
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Too many knees up.
Yes. That is right, Derek. You have 30 seconds now to talk on the next series, starting now.
I doubt whether, for me, there will be a next series, but I seem to...
Kenneth Williams challenged.
Deviation. He knows very well he's in it. I mean, it's rubbish to sit there and say, I doubt for me, and all this nonsense.
Well,
Nicholas, do you think I'm going to be in the next series or not?
Well, it's nothing to do with me casting.
If you don't know what it would be if it wants to do with you.
I can tell you, if I had anything to do with casting...
Yes, you'd suck us. Go on, come out with it. Go on, admit it.
Come clean.
Go on, come clean.
I will come completely clean. If I had anything to do, which you know I happen to do with the casting, I would have the four of you back because I think you give the best value for money that the BBC has ever had. And I only suffer here the slings and arrows of your outrageous behaviour because I know it's all in a good cause and the show goes well as a result.
Is it going to charity?
Well said, Peter. I don't know what the challenge was, but I don't think Derek deserves it. And, Kenneth, you keep the subject of the next series, and there are 26 seconds left, starting now.
What is remarkable about the very saying, the next series, is that it contains this promise. Once again, the dulcet tones of yours truly will be heard on the air.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Deviation, he hasn't got dulcet tones. He's very noisy.
So that means that Derek had an incorrect challenge. You keep the subject. You have 13 seconds to continue, starting now.
Well, of course, I can alter my tones at will. And at
Clement Freud has challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
From the previous dulcet tones.
But he was still on the subject of the next series. So he didn't deviate from the subject on the card. He keeps going with 9 seconds on the subject of the next series, starting now.
And one looks forward with joy to the chairmanship of Nicholas Parsons again triumphing. A very mighty...
Peter Jones has challenged.
He can't be triumphing again because he hasn't triumphed yet.
That is your opinion. And I don't think...
Can we put it to the audience?
If you wish, do you wish to cheer for the tribe of Kenneth Williams at the challenge or boo for Kenneth Williams? All do it together now.
Hooray!
They agree with you, Peter, actually. So you get the subject. You've got 1 second to talk on it. The next series starting now.
I'm going to try harder.
We come to the end of the show, alas. And for once, our many-time winner, Clement Freud, finished in fourth place. He was just behind Kenneth Williams, which is an incredible place to be. And Kenneth was only just behind Derek Nimmo, which is a very uncomfortable place to be. And Derek was actually behind the best place to be, the winning place, which was held, and the last show of the series, by Peter Jones. A very genuine goodbye to all our listeners throughout the world. Thank you for your letters. Thank you for tuning in. And we hope that when the series returns, you will want to tune in again once again and enjoy Just a Minute. Until then, from all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch.